All right. Good evening and welcome to the College of Complexes. My name is Tim. I'd like to welcome everybody tonight to our infamous meeting of the college. The college consists of the following format. First, we'll have a brief announcements period. Then our speaker, Justin Tucker, will speak tonight for up to about an hour. Then we'll have a question and answer period. And then we'll go into our infamous rebuttal period. Our meetings normally go from about now to about 9 o'clock or so, but if we're still engaged in dialogue, since we don't have a restaurant to schedule with, we can keep it going for a while.
The rules.
Okay, the rules are two is one fool at a time, and the second is no personal attacks. That means I can't call Charlie a schmuck during the meeting. Okay, so Charlie, if you're ready, let's get started with the schedule. Let's get started with the announcements.
Okay, welcome everyone to meeting number 3,649 of the College of Complexes, the playground for people who think. Okay, first of all, again, as usual, we have a Google email group, which you're invited to join, as well as a meetup group, which you're invited to subscribe to. Instructions and links are provided at the top of our website. Another feature you may not be aware of is that we now have a linear, no frills, schedule. Again, the link to that is at the very top of the main website. It says current schedule. See, look at that, pretty cool, eh? All right, now, although I am not a capitalist, I will give an advertisement for our upcoming programs. I think we got about 13 or 14 here. On January the 2nd, there's been a change of programs. January 22nd.
Oh, 22nd. I thought you said 2nd.
January 22nd, there's been a change of programs due to recovery from COVID. And we're going to have John Beasley, co-director of the College of Complexes Dallas campus, be talking about a book he wrote, a topic called The Fleecing of America. And he's a good speaker. It should be an excellent program. We'll reschedule the other guys for another date. I'm in touch with them. On January the 29th, the farm workers will be here to tell about working conditions in the field. Bilingual program translated from Spanish to English. That's on the 29th. Running into February the 3rd, we're going to hear what's wrong with the Democratic Party and what needs to be done by Ken Williams. Good talk. I sat through it once already. February the 12th, the Illinois Green Party will be here to tell about their activities on initiatives and so forth, local candidates. Illinois Green Party on the 12th. Vote Green. February the 19th, we're going to have Stan Smith at Foreign Affairs discussing the U.S. war on Venezuela. You don't like them socialists. Anyhow, the 19th, I'm turning into the 26th. This is going to be an academic lecture on high-tech cars, self-driving cars. You just get in and you can do whatever you want, play a game of poker, you know, and you're there, you know. Luck, hopefully. Anyhow, Autorama on the 26th. Going into March, Dan, as I see he's online, he's really worried about us not having food and water. So we'll listen to hear if his concerns are genuine and if his solutions are appropriate or not. On the 19th, an author will be coming and he has a political memoir he's going to talk about. And more importantly, he's authored a political manifesto. Nothing I like better than a manifesto. On March the 26th, I see she's with us tonight, Jan Lee will be talking about the yin-yang dynamism. that she maintains is operative in the universe. We'll see if she is accurate or not in this regard. On April the 9th, we're beginning our Earth Day series of speakers. On the 9th, a Chicago organization puts on the film festival, but the One Earth Collective, you may not realize it, but we all occupy one Earth. On the 16th, this should be interesting. What is the potential of using hydrogen as clean energy? Learn all about it. They're converting a railroad freight engine to hydrogen, the Canadian Pacific. I knew about that. Let's see, and then we go into the 30th, and yours truly, this is the best talk I've ever given. I'm amazed how good it is. But I'm going to talk about forestation and the need to preserve the forests of the United States as the habitat of a primitive species. Anyhow, and least of all,
Bigfoot.
Hey, comments are now off.
Okay.
All right. And last of all, you were talking about watching videos, archives. Trying out a new thing here. Back on the main page, there's a link, and there's all kinds of videos documentaries, which are free and online.
Where's the link at, Charlie?
Go down a little bit. See the little guy?
Ah, free films online.
Yeah.
Okay.
Click on that. And there's an eclectic bunch of films. Now, if you wanted me to add one to the list, all over the place, movies and documentaries. I'd prefer not to have those talking head videos of loony guys, you know, or newscasts, but these are documentaries and movies. Everybody should find something. There's some films in Russia that I could have come across very interesting about the war. Anyhow, that's it, Tim. Take it away. Thank you, everyone.
Okay, and all right, Justin, if you're ready to start your presentation, again, let's let everybody mute themselves while we're at it. And
actually, I prefer people, as long as they're not too disruptive, to stay unmuted so I can hear the laughter and we can interact off each other that way.
Okay.
So I encourage to do that.
So you don't mind us being unmuted. Okay, Justin, go ahead and start
all
your
right,
presentation.
Can you see my screen?
And we can see it. And can everybody else see it?
Yes.
All right, good.
All right. Well, happy new year, everybody. Original program, it said that this was rated PG-13, but upon viewing it today before coming on, I decided it's probably more rated R, so I apologize. So trigger warning, this is going to be funny and possibly offensive to some. I also do not have as many Leonardo DiCaprio memes as I thought I had, but it's okay. We got plenty of Justin Amash to make up for those. So here's what the Libertarian Party of Illinois is up to at the moment. Turns out the Cook County Clerk's Office, even though that we are an established party in Illinois, Cook County Clerk's Office decided it only applies for our countywide office because this is a year where they redraw the maps. Well, so therefore, you know, board of commissioner districts and other lower level offices in the General Assembly, et cetera, do not count. And stay tuned, Libertarian Illinois, maybe taking some action against that. Some other news, we petition period started this week. Libertarian Party of Chicago has petitions on their website, lpchicago.org, and also go to tinyurl.com, tinyurl.com/lpcook2022, and you can download the petition there. Stay tuned also for a PO box. We're going to provide an address to, if you're circulating the petitions, you can send them in and we can all bind them together when we turn them in. Our candidates are Thea Satsos for County Board President, Joseph Schreiner for County Clerk, Brad Sandifer for Sheriff, Michael Murphy for Treasurer, and Nico Satsoulis for Assessor. Very strong candidates. And if you want to, if you live in Chicago, want to sign my petition, just let me know, and we can make that happen. We also have a couple endorsed candidates running for board districts to help us kind of fight the county clerk. Jim Hume is running in the first commissioner's district. Jason Ross Decker's running in the 5th. Brandon Sizelove in the 11th.
Whoop whoop.
Libertarian Party of Illinois, we had our convention back in October, and we nominated Bill Redpath for U.S. Senate, Scott Schluter for U.S. Governor, John Phillips for Lieutenant Governor, and Jesse White for Secretary of State. You heard that right, Jesse White for Secretary of State. And we're going to need all the help we can getting these candidates on the ballot. So I ask all you guys to visit lpillinois.org, click on this donate button, and make a donation if you can, please. Now, on with the show. So, what is a meme? Well, a meme comes from the word mumeme, which means to mime, and it comes from it's Richard Dawkins coined it, and his definition is how things spread throughout culture, ideas, and things. But in the context of this, presentation, it's basically images that are shared on the internet, social media, websites, image boards, and the libertarians, I must admit, are awesome at making memes, as you will see. Memes are a folk art. The reason it's a folk art is because people have more access to make graphics than ever. Anybody can be an artist. Anybody can share anything on the internet. And so this whole sort of art form just emerged from the bottom up.
Okay, Justin, we can only see that Libertarian Party of Chicago. If you wanted to,
Tim, I know. I'm still talking. Please, this is one full at a time. I'm quite aware.
Okay, that's all I needed to know. Sorry about that.
Building up.
So, memes are made by people we call meme lords or meme smiths. So, Carl Walker, Libertarian Party of Chicago's fundraising chair, awesome meme smith. He does work for us and the state party and some other avenues. So, a lot of the memes you'll see tonight are from him. What is a dank meme stash? Well, a dank meme stash is basically your collection of memes. You can have them on your hard drive, you can have them in a group on Facebook, you can have them in a Dropbox somewhere, you can have them in your Google Drive. A meme stash is basically where you keep your memes. Some popular memes right now include taxation is theft, a classic one, never going away. Epstein didn't kill himself, still strong after a few years, even though I think he did kill himself. Another recent meme that probably has peaked, but worth noting, is John McAfee didn't kill himself. Again, I think he probably did kill himself. And probably the best known meme at the moment right now is Let's Go Brandon, which comes from NASCAR fans saying Brandon, but the reporter at the scene said Let's Go Brandon. So people who dislike President Biden will say Let's Go Brandon, and that's one of the hottest memes going on right now. So let's see here. Let's take a look at some of the memes that are kind of national, that are from a national party or national party perspective. So libertarians are the most liberation party, always have been. This is a funny meme format. It's silly. It's just these astronauts in space. One of them's out in space looking at Earth, and the guy just pulling a gun on them. And it's always have been. It's funny. You might see a couple more of these throughout the night. Here's some artwork that the national party already against the next mandate. And you can see we also adapted one, as I had shown earlier. By the way, these are no real particular order, so might go off in crazy directions. Trans rights are natural rights. No one has the right to control your body but you. Donald Trump, State of the Union Address, America will never be a socialist country, except for Medicare, Medicaid, universal public education, bank bailouts, SNAP, public family leave, et cetera, et cetera. Taxation is theft. Had enough? Vote libertarian. Prostitution is basically capitalism and sex, which are those two. Are you against? I'm for both, says Joe Jorgensen, our 2020 presidential nominee. As president, I will repeal all laws for crimes without a victim. Nobody should be denied their freedom for an offense that harms no one. Justin Amash, this is from when he recently joined the party back in 2020. Welcome home. Also from around 2020, Black Lives Matter, that's for sure. Joe Jorgensen talks here about the US prison population jump from 350,000 to 2.3 million in 30 years. The overall crime rate went down. However, how is this possible? Long sentences, mandatory minimums, increase in drug laws. Let's end the war on drugs, guys. Joe Jorgensen, no sexual allegations, PhD, college professor, entrepreneur. She was a good candidate. I really like Joe. So Joe, 100 years after women's suffrage, she got 1% of the vote, over a million votes. So good, go Joe. There is a large untapped market of people who are libertarian and just don't know it yet, or don't know about the movement. Could you be a libertarian? It does not have to be passively not racist. You must be actively anti-racism, says the Libertarian Party. Good ideas do not require force. We do not have a drug problem. We have a prohibition problem. The government should not be interfering with the free market, nor should it bail out companies. Libertarian Party is America's party. Our principles are America's principles. These are the principles of the vast majority of the people in this country, even if some do not yet realize it. Your tears are delicious and your parties will die. Sorry, we have been forced to close due to COVID. We did a resolution of a national committee in 2020. We've been consistently anti-mandate since right around the time of the start of the pandemic.
Did you get the employees to vote?
I'm sorry?
Did you get the employees to vote?
Did I get the employees to vote?
Yeah, they have to.
Yeah. If you're, I'm sure a lot of people.
Their family. So some guy can make money, right?
I'm quite understanding what you're saying, Charlie, but I'm going to move on here.
Justin, for the last slide, what did it say? The smaller text. I didn't really
want to read this, but
this was the other one.
Anyways, I'm gonna continue. I skipped over that because I didn't want to read it, but it was about George Floyd. Let's ask questions at the ends. I still want to hear your laughter. Interject where you think it's necessary, but please, questions for the end. I'm sure you guys read this, but by now, here's a quote from Ludwig von Mises. Google Ludwig von Mises if you like. Let them come. One old party creates an unjust law, the other enforcements. Libertarians think it's wrong to tear children from their parents because they crossed a line. Repeal unjust legislation. So, recent memes. This is the 10-year challenge meme of the national debt from 2012 to 2022. Almost doubled. Wow. Insane.
It did double.
Double, more than doubled.
22 to 2022.
This is, if you look at those dollars end to end, it'll take light 4 hours to reach. So it takes, yeah, wow. The Supreme Court blocks the federal government's COVID. We are not government property. Thank you, Supreme Court. Libertarian Party supports that. On vaccines, you can either be a Republican, say it's a bioweapon and drink urine. Democrats, you can mandate them, you get the jab, or we take your jab. Or libertarians, medical choices are between you and your doctor. Truth is treason in an empire of lies, says Ron Paul. Yeah. We condemn bigotry as irrational and repugnant. Police are out of control because they're out of your control. Demilitarize your police, unqualified immunity, push for systemic reform. Justin Amash, he introduced HR 7085 after he became the first libertarian to serve in Congress, and nothing really happened with it, unfortunately. This is Libertarian Pledge. You sign this when you you check this off. You know, you agree to this when you join the party. I hereby certify that I do not believe or advocate the initiation of violence as a means of achieving political or social goals, the non-aggression principle. The LP platform, the United States should both avoid entangling alliances and abandon its attempts to act as a policeman for the world. We condemn the use of force to achieve political or social goals. Take pride in freedom. The law should not deny, abridge, or grant rights to people based on their gender or sexual identity. It is not to be passively not racist. You must be actively anti-racist. Joe Jorgensen on the campaign trail. Gary Johnson, this is from 2020, but sadly he's talking about how nothing happened with the Qualified Immunity Act that you introduced. Thanks, Gary, for bringing that out there. Spike Cohen, the problem is not that there are individual apples that are bad. The problem is that the barrel is bad. Let's not ban Newports to save Black people is the most racist thing I've heard so far today. Bailouts suck, says Spike Cohen, basically. Build back better equals make again. Biden is blue MAGA. That's a good one. Yeah, Libertarian Party, we believe this system's flawed. We want to bring reform. Please join Libertarian Party if you want to help us. Here's one recently that replying to Lori Lightfoot. We are not government property. This is not leadership. It is the tyrants whose time is up.
Yeah. Is it tyrant because she wants people to be safe?
Yeah, it's okay to be undemocratic just because you know, you want to make people safe. So Tulsi Gabbard had a quote and we kind of shortened it for her, but she's in the right ballpark. Maybe one day she'll come on through. We are not government property. Welcome home if you believe in freedom for all. We reject racism, sexism, and we support truly free markets. And there's that one in that folder. Let me move on through the rest of my stash here. Here's what's going on in Illinois. Again, no particular. Hey, we know this guy. So this is us last Sunday near Kimball and Wrightwood, right near Lori's house. We had a anti-mandate rally, and we marched down, back up Kimball, back down Milwaukee to the monument where we started. There's our sheriff's candidate, Brad Sandifer, on the bullhorn. There's us from another perspective there in front of the mayor's place. There's Brad Sandifer. Sandifer for sheriff. Google, donate. He wants to put enforcement back in law enforcement. Here's a couple graphics from newly elected libertarians. You got Brody Anderson, congratulations. Jonathan Russell, congratulations. Kelly Liebman, congratulations. Here's one that Carl did for our In the War on Drugs rally, our first one that we marched down to the mayor. Also, they wouldn't let us get past the barricades, but a good time. Here's some of our members and stuff with Vermin Supreme, with our beloved friend Joshua Flynn, and with Glenn Olofsson, who is a friend of the chapter, our Danny Maloff, who is our Senate candidate, and a few others. Here's some, you might know some of these guys. There's Joshua Flynn, again, missed the guy. Yeah. Bill Redpath, federal government needs to enhance economic freedom nation by urging states to drop barriers to employment due to excessive occupational licensing. Let's abolish the Hall-Rabushka flat tax, or adopt, excuse me. Let's adopt, says Bill Redpath. We want to stimulate the economy. The federal government should get out of the way because the only money they can spend is the money they must steal from taxpayers or print with the help of the Federal Reserve. Gee, I wonder why we have so much inflation. Scott Schluter, governor candidate. The pension fund for Illinois lawmakers is the most bankrupt in the nation. I will work with legislators to build a plan that will honor current contracts while giving current employees the freedom to leave the pension systems and save for retirement through a self-managed plan. Thank you, Scott.
Go for a buyout.
There is much to be done, but together we can build a better Illinois. Illinois is one of the worst states for law-abiding guns. I will work with the members of the General Assembly to repeal both the Foyt Act and the Concealed Carry Act. When I am elected, I will proudly sign legislation to ensure addicts receive treatment instead of jail sentences. It only took us 13 years to realize that alcohol prohibition doesn't work, yet we haven't seemed to learn our lesson with the other drugs. Carl made this meme, great meme, quoting George Washington, if freedom of speech is taken away, then dumb and silent, we may be led like sheep to the slaughter. Samuel Adams, a time should come when vain and aspiring men shall possess the highest seats in government. Our country will stand in need of its experienced patriots to prevent its ruin. Benjamin Franklin, ordaining a law, ordaining of laws in favor of one part of the nation to prejudice and oppression of another is certainly the most erroneous and mistaken policy. An equal dispensation of protection, rights, privileges, and advantages is what every part is entitled to and ought to enjoy. Bill Redpath here on Twitter, he says, LP National is fighting socialism and doing so much less. No conspiracy mongering, no right-wing authoritarianism, no electoral repression, which is mainly affected through ridiculously punitive ballot access laws. Please support me for U.S. Senate in 2022. Go Bill. I gave him 10 bucks the other day. Give him 10 bucks too.
That's good. Fight socialism.
Right on.
A couple more quotes. Occupational licensing is a barrier to entry into the marketplace. Unfortunately, it harms the poor. Scott, as you probably can tell, big on the gun issue. He will veto any gun regulation that comes across his desk. He will immediately halt unconstitutional violations of your Second Amendment rights, issuing an executive order to state agencies prohibiting them from arresting anybody for violations of the Floyd Act.
I thought Joshua for Flynn, law enforcement.
Joshua Flynn, our departed friend. I got tired of seeing young boys that needed strong guidance, so I worked to connect young boys in the inner city with mentors. I got tired of hearing about the school to prison pipeline and its connection to reading scores, so I specifically worked with third and fourth grade children to help enhance their reading skills. I got tired of the lie that Black people can't protect themselves, so I started inspiring people to carry, get trained, and I became a resource for beginners to connect with firearm trainers that look like them. I always tell people you can be the LeBron of your hood. I implore people to not just rally about the things you care about, but implement actionable specific solutions to your cause. We are the leaders, whether our stories make it to the nightly news primetime slot or not. I greatly miss Josh, and he was, you guys have met him. He spoke at the college before we, that was very emotional, me reading that. So we do miss Josh. Jimmy May.
What did he die from, Justin? He was awful young.
I'm gonna answer that later. I'm gonna move on. Jim Humay is running, as I mentioned, Cook County Board. If you want to check him out, there you can look at him. Jason Ross Decker mentioned he's running the 5th. There he boarded up lots of houses out there in southern Cook County. So if you want to help him, he reach out. He encourages it. I think I've always been an underdog, which is great because there's less pressure. Plus the odds always pay better on underdogs. There's another cool meme that he has, Jason Ross Decker. I'm just a working class blue collar citizen. I'm a very blessed and lucky father, husband. I'm a political outsider and community organizer, excelling in service and safety. I owe no favors. I have no ulterior motives and I have no strings to be pulled. What you see is what you get. There's me with my friend, Jason. Oh gosh, I'm blanking right now. but we collected 3,300 signatures, volunteer total. Come on. One of my libertarian friends on the call.
Spires.
Thank you. Thank you. He got 30 years for cannabis, got out. Now he's in Stanford University. And the Illinois Policy Institute covered his story. Here's Joshua Flynn again. The opposition of liberty is serfdom, slavery, bondage, servitude, and vassalage. Above all else, liberty is the absence of coercion. Freedom enables the individual to create. Moreover, freedom enables the individual to help out his fellow man. Josh's button. I have a button. I think I'm going to donate to University of Illinois Chicago in their archives. So if you got libertarian stuff and you want to preserve it for posterity, like this button, reach out to me. All right. There's the same quote I just read, but different angle of Josh. He looked really good in that suit. That was a good suit, Miss Josh. Freedom enables the individual to create. By the way, this book, Black Libertarianism in the Blue State, is on Amazon. Pick up a copy. A righteous person seeks self-reliance, autonomy. Who would care for his or her neighbors? Who would respect the rights and the freedom of others, and who will not infringe upon the individual liberties of man? Another angle of Josh from a different quote. Hey, I know those guys. Josh, and then there's Brian Dennehy on the left there. Early voting there in Oak Park, where Josh, you're in Josh's district. Josh was endorsed by the Fraternal Order of Police, and he did it on a police reform platform.
Yep.
So congratulations, Josh. That was an awesome endorsement. He also was endorsed by the Chicago Tribune. Carl made this cool cover photo for Libertarian Party of Illinois. Friedrich Hayek says, emergencies have always been the pretext in which the safeguards of liberty have been eroded, and once they are suspended, it is not difficult for anyone who has assumed emergency powers to see that the emergencies will persist. There is no greater tyranny than that which is perpetuated under the shield of the law in the name of justice, says Montesquieu. We don't condone the behavior of the majority of politicians during the COVID pandemic. However, we will not wish torture, death, or stripping citizenship upon them. That's not what libertarians stand for. Bill Redpath, again, instead of passing a $3.5 billion infrastructure bill that will only further burden taxpayers, the duopoly need to repeal the Jones Act. For over 100 years, it was restricted water transportation of cargo between U.S. ports that are U.S. owned. Thanks, Bill. Vote for Bill. Hey, I know these guys. Doing some sign waving for Josh. Spike Cohen, this is from our convention back in October. They did the auction. It was a good time. Thank you, Justin Amash and Spike Cohen, for coming out. Let me move on to another piece of my stash here. For the sake of time, I might skip over some of these because I did a lot. But hey, you know what? Here, donate to the Libertarian Party of Illinois, lpillinois.org. Click on that donate button. Here's Ayn Rand. There are two potential violators of man's rights, the criminals and the government. Happy Easter. Happy holidays. Happy New Year. 24th Amendment to the Constitution. That is a poll tax. That's unconstitutional. Martin Niemöller, he was a Lutheran minister during Nazi Germany, and he wrote a book called God is My Führer. And you've seen this before. First they came for the socialists, but I did not speak out because I'm not a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists, but I did not speak out because I'm not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews. I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak for me. Gustave de Molinari, economist. Just as war is a natural consequence of monopoly, peace is the natural consequence of liberty. Jose Marti, men have no special rights simply because they belong to one race or another. When you say men, you have already imbued them with all their rights. Juneteenth, we celebrated that. End qualified immunity now, quoting Justin Amash. The pattern continues because police are legally, politically, and culturally insulated from the consequences for violating the rights of the people whom they sort of serve. put on that big and quickest in the immediate aftermath of a crisis, real or manufactured, says Bob Barr, also a member of Congress. I want to go through some of these. Have you made your donation to Libertarian Party of Chicago? Hey guys, lpchicago.org/donate if you'd like to donate. This is our slate from 2020. This is the big one, big flyer version. We had candidates on the ballot and also write-ins. Bill Redpath was running for Congress at that time, but some people we already mentioned are on here. Notably, we also had Professor Deidre McCloskey running in the 7th District for Congress. Another version of that. I'm going to fly through some of these. Liberty not only means that the individual has both the opportunity and the burden of choice, it also means that he must bear the consequences of his actions and receive praise or blame for them. Liberty and responsibility are inseparable. John Hospers, if each human being is to have liberty, he cannot also have the liberty to deprive others of their liberty. Carl Hess, libertarianism is rejected by the modern left, which preaches individualism but practice collectivism. Capitalism is rejected by the modern right, which preaches enterprise but practices protectionism. Looking at you, Donald Trump. Without the reestablishment of freedom of migration throughout the world, there can be no lasting peace, says Ludwig von Mises. Thomas Sowell from the University of Chicago, it is hard to imagine a more stupid or more dangerous way of making decisions than by decisions in the hands of people who pay no price for being wrong. This is one of my favorite Bastiat quotes. When law and morality contradict each other, the citizen has the cruel alternative of losing his moral sense or losing his respect for the law. The state is the great fictitious entity by which everyone seeks to live at the expense of everyone else. L'état, c'est le grand physician à travers le cas tout le monde. I had it memorized in French. L'état, c'est le grand fiction à travers lequel tout le monde.
I think Abraham Lincoln said it better.
Anywho,
there's more pigs than tits.
Happy Labor Day from the Libertarian Party for our labor friends. We're all workers. Libertarians work hard, just as any other worker would. So happy Labor Day.
That's a union.
No, we're not.
Yeah, you don't want to pay union dues.
Well, nobody should be forced to pay union dues who don't want to join the union, Charlie. No, it isn't. Hey, one full at a time here, buddy.
What are you in the union by name only?
Charlie, one full at a time. All right, Spike Cohen here. Even if a sizable minority simply refuses to comply, the order becomes unenforceable and eventually gets repealed. We saw this with the mask mandates in several places across the U.S. where they were ignored by a few and then many and then almost everyone, and then they were repealed. Pardon me. The fact that the government, like a highwayman, says to a man, your money or your life, and many, if not most, taxes are paid under that compulsion of that threat. Lysander Spooner. One has a moral responsibility to disobey unjust laws. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Man is not made for the state. The state is made for man. To deprive a man of freedom is to relegate him to the status of a thing rather than elevate him to the status of a person. Man must never be treated as a means to the end of a state, but always as an end within himself. Save the world. Donate to Libertarian Party of Chicago, lpchicago.org/donate. Happy birthday, Ludwig von Mises. I think that was back in September, if I'm not mistaken. It was his birthday. There's that one. Let me continue on to the next little batch. here within my stash. Let's look at some Justin Amash. He does some really awesome Twitter stuff. And here we go. So this is his co-sponsors for the Qualified Immunity Act. My representative, Chewy Garcia, did it. You got AOC is on the list there. Joe Kennedy. You got some more people. It's a lot of folks there, right? Go Justin. Too bad nothing else happened with it. Libertarianism is about removing arbitrary barriers between people who want to peacefully engage with one another. In the drug war, if you like statism, you're going to love racially motivated nanny statism. Yep, another poke at the menthol cigarette ban there. Political parties exist to organize people to win elections. If you want to do activism, go out and start a nonprofit.
Justin, can you not spin through these quite so fast so we can let them sink in a little bit?
Sure. I will slow my pace. It's the party controlling the White House that always forgets the elections have consequences. Americans don't just elect a president. We elect Congress, governors, legislators, mayors, councils. Powers are divided, not concentrated in one person. The president is not a king. End qualified immunity, end civil asset forfeiture, end the war on drugs, end overcriminalization, end no-knock warrants, end militarization of police, end mandatory minimums. The Constitution limits government and protects individual rights. Qualified immunity limits individual rights and protects government. Defend the Constitution, end qualified immunity. Hey, that ending Qualified Immunity Act is officially tripartisan. Congratulations, Justin Amash, for a tripartisan bill. Happy birthday, USA. So he said a couple years ago on July 4th. As you can see, Justin Amash, you know, police reform is a big topic of his. He came really out swinging after the George Floyd situation. So thank you, Justin Amash.
Who is Justin Amash again?
Justin Amash was a Republican representative in Congress. After Trump became elected, he left the GOP, was an independent for some time. Then he became a libertarian, joined the LP. And he became the first libertarian to serve in Congress. He didn't run for re-election after that, but he was at our state convention back in October, and he's an awesome guy. Favorite movie is The Tree of Life, which if you are a big film nerd like me, and you like Terrence Malick, you know how good of a movie that is. But Justin Amash was very good at criminal justice putting that messaging out there. And I hope that he, you know, I hope in the future that more things come for sure. What happened to support for local decision making? State governments should neither mandate mask wearing nor prohibit local units from mandating mask wearing. I agree with that. So Rick DeSantis, I think, did that, as well as you got mandates here in Illinois. In qualified immunity, he's at it again. The government sucks. Justin Amash knows what's up. In no-knock warrants, end qualified immunity, justice for Breonna Taylor, who you may remember was shot in a no-knock raid. More than 2 months ago, so this is back when he was still in Congress as a libertarian, more than 2 months ago, I introduced a four-page tripartisan bill to protect the rights of the people by identifying qualified immunity. Congress can pass it, but that requires the speaker to bring it up to a vote. It's way past time to get it done. United States Postal Service. Yeah, whatever. Who cares? I'm gonna scroll through some of these.
Remember, I care about the Postal Service.
So do well,
I don't have all the time in the world. I got so many more memes.
Oh, we got plenty of time. We got plenty of time. Put that back. I want to see what he said about the Postal Service.
All right, fine. U.S. to U.S. You can't make changes to improve overall service if it impacts any service, and we'll give you $25 billion. The bill makes no sense because it's not intended to make sense. Only no one will scrutinize the actual test. It's meant as political messaging. Remember 9/11. Honor the victims. Seek peace, not war. So Justin Amash, in addition to the Civil Asset Forfeiture Act, he also introduced the National Emergencies React Form, which automatically sunsets emergencies unless Congress can meet or vote to sustain designation in 40 hours of reconvening. All national emergencies expire 60 days after enactment unless Congress votes to continue them. He also introduced the Protect Asylum Seekers Act and the Practical Alternatives to Detention Act to protect immigrants from unnecessary prosecution, detention, family separation. Our country was founded on the principle that human rights are inherent and deserve protection. He introduced a constitutional amendment. Equality before the law shall be guaranteed by the United States and the several states. This amendment serves to more directly incorporate the concept of rule of law into the Constitution. That's something maybe we can continue, maybe we can do a movement to keep trying to get introduced that in that amendment to the Constitution with each Congress, unless someone's already done it. Donald Trump is a demagogue who is inciting an insurrection against our Constitution. That's from January 6th, 2021.
Republicans would find that offensive.
That's true. These strikes are unconstitutional and dangerous. There's no general authority for a president to launch airstrikes, and President Biden hasn't claimed we're ready to stop an imminent threat. Our Constitution demands he get approval from the representatives of the people. This is his memorial to his colleague, John Lewis, who passed away. Imagine making it a crime to offer water to people waiting in line to vote. So Kristen Hildebrand says paid leave is infrastructure, child care is infrastructure, caregiving is infrastructure, to which Justin Amash says we are all infrastructure now. Yeah. All right. Stop treating traffic stops like commando operations and stop making absurd laws that create a pretext for traffic stops. End the war on drugs, folks. Justice for George Floyd, says Justin Amash. For the liberal, i.e. libertarian, any system which does not exclude every violent interruption of peaceful development is, from the outset, out of the question, Ludwig von Mises. Dan Crenshaw says, I've drafted a bill that prohibit political censorship on social media by making changes to Section 230. Justin Amash replies, James Madison drafted a Bill of Rights with the First Amendment that prohibits political censorship by Dan Crenshaw. Snap. The old parties wanted to force a binary choice, red or blue. But views don't divide neatly along one axis. Libertarianism recognizes that humans have diverse preferences. We welcome people of all backgrounds who choose to engage peacefully with one another. Diversity is our unity. In the mandates, says Justin Amash. I agree. This was the summer of 2020. Donald Trump is a threat to our liberty, mm-hmm. our constitution, and rule of law. All right. So thank Justin Amash is the coolest dude in the libertarian movement right now, in my opinion. Wait, here's my meme stash. Okay. So well, let's move on to other memes here. So here's Bernie Sanders. These memes were very popular. This was taken from his campaign ad where he said, I'm once again asking for your financial support. So people have taken that and ran with it with very funny results. Me to Congress after I spend the stimulus check in 3 days. I am once again asking for your financial support. I am once again asking you to ignore 20th century boycott associated with my ideology. You guys have seen, oh, by the way, these are also in no order. So I don't even know, this is potpourri. I don't know what's coming up. But Joshua Dial, who you may have seen in Tiger King. I'm a libertarian. So technically F the feds. He came and spoke to our chapter. He also did some, did some fundraising for Joshua Flynn too. So thank you, Joshua Dial. The summer of 2020, man, what a time. This is the Capitol Hill Autonomous Zone Twitter. Attention to the person attempting to establish an autonomous zone within the autonomous zone. Do not do this. Hashtag Chaz. That only lasted what? A couple weeks? Something like that.
Didn't go too well.
Joe Jorgensen, as president, I will use my constitutional authority to end federal civil asset forfeiture prior to conviction and pardon persons convicted of nonviolent victimless crimes. Go Joe. Do you own a gun? The beauty of the right to right and keep and bear arms is to keep violent criminals guessing which citizens can defend themselves and which ones can't. This deters crime. Communism in theory. We will have a classless society. It will be great. Communism in practice, a big giant gold statue to Mao Zedong. This is a popular meme format. It's this guy and he's an animated cartoon and he's looking at a butterfly and he asks a question like, is this something or other? And you'll get the hang of it here. Republicans, looking at people voting, is this voter fraud? Because I guess when they think people vote, it's fraudulent. I apologize. I live close to a firehouse and they're pulling out there. So I don't know if you can hear that in the background, but I apologize. All right. Tommy Lahren, who you may know from Fox, not the sharpest whatever in the drawer. If Donald Trump were to lose, he won't. His supporters will go to work tomorrow, just as we do every day. When Biden loses, his supporters will likely loot and riot. Tells you everything you needed to know. Tweets that did not age well. So here's a popular meme format. This is from the movie Predator. And you got Schwarzenegger and Carl Weathers, and they like, you know, grab arms. And, you know, as you can see, one side and both sides coming together and what they agree on is kind of like the premise of the meme. So communist and fascist both ban certain music, arts and music. They both prevent freedom of thought, burning books, tearing down statues, censoring speech, punishing dissenting voices. These make fun of these kind of like, you know, Law and Order guys. Two things I love, outlaw country and the law. Oh. Easter morning message, taxation is God.
Oh, God.
That's good.
That's
good. I'm glad a monotheist posted that, not a secularist like me. Thank you, Justin.
I'm gonna have to go to confession for that one.
Naughty, naughty, sir. That's brutal.
Places where weed is legal. Okay. Is this strawberry milkshake chihuahua haze? No, this is gelato, AK-47, for focus kush. And then people wear places it's not legal. Which kind of weed is this? Weed. There's Milton Friedman. Late stage capitalism? Nah. We're just getting started with the laser eyes.
Yes.
Here we see Jesus knocking on doors to collect taxes for feeding the less fortunate. Knocking with a gun. Is anybody
in
there?
That was in the sequel, right? No, I'm kidding.
Communist and non-communist countries. They're like the Lincoln lawyer, you know? Very attractive, very handsome. You got Matthew McConaughey there. Then you got the disheveled Matthew McConaughey from Dallas Buyers Club. Communist in actual communist countries. That's pretty funny, man. This is the anarcho-capitalist ball. These balls represent ideologies, and this is the anarcho-communist ideology. They always have the sunglasses and thumbs up. When you're in breadline and everyone in front of you starves to death, so you take the bread intended for them and eat it yourself, but the guy behind you reports you to the commune council for not distributing the bread equally, and they have you shot. All right, so you got Joe Biden on one side, Brendan Fraser on the other. As you can see, Biden voted for the war in Iraq, but not Brendan Fraser. Brendan Fraser. Biden was accused of sexual harassment. Brendan Fraser was not. Joe Biden did not star in The Mummy, but Brendan Fraser did. The choice is obvious.
So he wasn't Encino Man.
Yeah. That might be more of a Gen X reference for some of you older folks. So you got Sarah Connor here. Is that her name? From
Terminator.
Terminator, yes. Thank
Sarah
you.
Sarah Connor.
Yeah. Sarah Connor. So this is Sarah Connor when she first learns about libertarianism. I finally looked into libertarianism. I'm interested in learning more. So 6 months later, she's got her gun. She's out in the desert. She's stockpiling. She's waiting for the apocalypse. I've witnessed people actually do this. They go from like, you know, hey, to like ANCAP over a period of time. It does happen. It's funny. Libertarians, feel free to voluntarily organize socialist arrangements within your capitalist country. Socialists, no. Nobody's stopping you from your worker commune or your whatever. Todd Starnes, I think he's a Republican kind of operative, if I'm not mistaken. For every American who is killed, a city in Afghanistan should be wiped off the face of the earth. Later in somewhere else in time, he says, "Dear Lord, we ask you to place a hedge of protection around Americans who are abandoned by their government in Afghanistan. Watch over our Afghan allies. Protect our troops as they strike down the enemy." In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Yeah. Invoking Jesus to, wiping people out. I know they are actually at a food bank, but there's something about putting socialists in front of empty shelves that feels meme-worthy. You got that one, I forget her name at the right now, from
Rashida Tlaib.
Yes, from Michigan, and you got Bernie Sanders. Empty shelves. Yeah,
she and Amash, right, both served in different parts of Michigan. She still serves.
So here's, some of you wrestling fans may know that this is CM Punk. You know, walking down to the ring, and a fan who is represented as conservatives offering, I guess he's offering him a drink. The drink says, "You're just virtue signaling," to which he says, or he's supposed, you know, anyone with half a brain and the slightest bit of empathy, like, virtue signaling is not an argument against anything. Mission accomplished. Biden has ended liberty. So there's an airplane in the sky. Tax the rich is is spelled out in the sky from the airplane. Powerful. AOC writes tax the rich in the sky for a private jet. Funny. Evil Bernie Sanders be like, I don't own a $575,000 lakefront vacation home. I donated that to the poor. So here's another meme format. It's from one of the X-Men movies. And it's, I prefer, I said the real, and then perfection. And it goes, yeah. So Cuba, I prefer the real socialism. Venezuela, I said the real socialism. Fantasyland, perfection. Might see a couple more of these tonight, maybe. We'll see. Socialist Rifle Association. Communists use guns as tools to oppose political oppression. Didn't communists use guns to politically oppress people during the Chinese Cultural Revolution? They probably deserved it. I know there's, I think Charlie might later on tonight talk about how maybe people deserved it during the Soviet Union. We'll see. So you got George Washington, erect middle finger. When you hear someone using kilometers per hour instead of freedoms per eagle. Freedoms per eagle. That's a very good metric that we should adopt.
That's yeah.
Hey, Tim, like thorium reactors, how many freedoms per eagle can they generate per hour?
I like that one. The problem is, Justin, though, there's a little bit of a lie about that one. Communal measurement also promotes commerce. You know, It's a barrier to have the English in the metric system. We should be adopting the metric system worldwide in order to promote free trade. That way there's no confusion in the standards and the standards over time, you know.
Sounds good, Tim, but you can save that for rebuttals. We're going to move on. So you got a communist guy there on the left crying, no, you can't support a market economy. You should read theory. To which the Chad with the cool beard says, yes. And it looks like he's got some Milton Friedman. He's got Hayek. He's got Adam Smith. He's got some Robert Nozick in there. So good philosophy. So the GOP tweeted, the numbers don't lie. American people are rejecting Joe Biden, Kamala Harris, and their failing agenda. So the LP replied, the numbers also didn't lie in November 2020 when they rejected Trump. It's almost like both parties are dying. Trump, immigrants are taking our jobs and are responsible for our low wages. F off. I don't believe in that nonsense. So true. But when he looks at it, Bernie Sanders, when he says, immigrants are taking our jobs and are responsible for our low wages. So here we got another one of those memes again. Bernie Sanders, I prefer the real champion of the workers. Karl Marx, I said the real champion of the workers, to which we get to Milton Friedman, perfection.
You're wearing a plaid suit? Whoa.
It was the 60s or 70s. I mean.
No, he rocked it. And he retired from Chicago to San Francisco. I mean, the dude had panache.
Conservatives. Ashley Babbitt should not have been shot for rioting. Kyle Rittenhouse is a hero for killing rioters. Which is it, conservatives? Make up your mind. So this is a meme. Maybe there's another one of these later. I don't know, but this is from the Chick Tract. If you're aware of those, they're comic books for Christian. They're like Christian comic strips that are horrible. But anyways, so it's Jesus talking to the high priests. Taxation is theft. Shut up. Those people rejected his message. They hated Jesus because he told them the truth. Looks like you got some guy whose parents are from Eastern Europe, perhaps. Most of my grandma's family starved to death in 1933. Stalin was a murderer. And then you got college liberal lady drinking her, was that kombucha or something? I don't know. No. Oh, we got another one of these memes again, like I mentioned earlier, leftists. Looking at the butterfly, slightly different leftists. Is this the moderate wing of fascism? Lots of liberals, like leftists rather, like to call things fascist. Yeah, I support Build Back Better. B, giving money to cronies. B, increasing public debt. B, making inflation worse. Here we go. We got this one other meme again. You got anti-immigrant nationalist and anti-scab unionist coming together. Don't let them cross that line. They're undercut they'll undercut our wages. Oh man. Guy on Twitter, his name's Bastiat, Everyday Bastiat. So you got a Last Supper with Marx there in the middle. You got Stalin and Lenin and Castro and Che and others. Mao's there. You can tell that this is a communist rendition of the Last Supper because there's plenty of theory and nothing to eat. And it doesn't even look like there's a lot of theory in, there anyway. So this woman, I Googled her. She's like a seminarian or like a theology student or professor or something. I forget which. At like Duke, I believe. So Duke is like Methodist and Quaker college, if I'm not mistaken. Every discussion of biblical womanhood should include the fact that in the first chapter of Luke, two pregnant women celebrate their new motherhood by passionately discussing the coming overthrow of every earthly empire. Merry Christmas, everybody. So we got the bullseye where taxes are supposed to go, but where they went, way off. Way off. I think this one might be another one. I don't know. I think Carl might be associated with this VIA group who made this meme, I think. Something with voluntarism, maybe. I'll ask him later. Teach your daughter to shoot because a restraining order is just a piece of paper.
They can go to school.
Why do you keep resisting Marxism? Well, I love food more than I hate successful people. Okay, here's a Leonardo DiCaprio meme, as promised. If George Orwell were alive today, he'd be like, so you got Leonardo DiCaprio with his making the space. This is from Django Unchained. And the meme is kind of like a trickster, like a, you know, he's just laughing at stuff. And, you know, we might see a couple more of these similar memes throughout the night, but that's a Leo DiCaprio meme, like I said, there would be. So you got Spider-Man, adults believing the government will fix their problems, looking at the Green Goblin, kids believing in Santa, you and I are not so different. So let's do a side-by-side comparison of Stalin and Santa. They both like red. They both live in a very cold place. They both have a mustache. They both have a naughty list. So this is another meme format we might see throughout the night. This is what's even funnier about this meme. It's from I think Star Wars Attack of the Clones, maybe.
It was an awful movie.
But even this meme format is not even in the movie. It's just people made a meme, and this meme format just came because somebody, I don't know, it's interesting. That's how memes work. But this guy, so Anakin Skywalker represents communism. Why wail over broken eggs when we are trying to make an omelet? To which Padme says, but you'll make the omelet, right? And he becomes more sinister. But you'll make an omelet, right? Hey, another one of these meme formats. You got the capitalist fat cat. He who does not work shall not eat. F off. I don't believe that. Not made up nonsense. Now when Lenin says it, he who does not work shall not eat. So true. So communist being hypocrites again. And I think also St. Paul said that too. Tankies. Any looking at the butterfly? Any critic of communism? Is this a fascist?
Yes.
Me and the boys reading the Communist Manifesto, laughing our butts off in a Tom and Jerry cartoon.
I can't.
So you got the inventor of Monopoly there on the left, and you got Chad Chen there on the right. So the inventor of Monopoly says, "No, I invented Monopoly to teach you how bad capitalism you're not supposed to be having fun." Ha ha ha. You land on Park Place. Pay me $500, says Chad Chen.
No.
Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. Hey, Jesus. Socialist Jesus is coming to seize the means of production. He's got that gun. Another Jesus meme with a gun. These are funny, right? This is a really funny meme. I actually talked to my alderman the other day, and I explained this to him. This meme format is Vince McMahon from the World Wrestling Federation, and he gets more excited. Developers now have the right to bulldoze the single family home next to you. Hey, he digs it, and build multi-story, multi-unit buildings. Ooh, he gets more excited, and then. And you have no say in the matter, and he just can't control himself anymore. Voting in the two-party system, when you're throwing the recyclables and the landfill stuff in the same container. Libertarians. Sure wish more people understood inflation. More people. Stimulus checks can't cover my rent. Petition for $2,000 monthly stimulus checks have 3 million signatures. Americans need some certainty.
No.
Our former labor secretary under Clinton, Robert Reich, or I don't know, am I pronouncing that? Is it Reich or Rich? Is what is real. I think is probably how you actually pronounce it.
Right.
I have always wanted to meet Dolly Parton. We're the same age, same height, share the same values, but she can sing better. Hannah Cox, who's a libertarian writer, she's better at economics too. So if you guys have seen the movie Tommy Boy, you're acquainted with this scene where he just kind of sets the desk on fire and crashes cars. Explaining Fed policy to kids. Just printing it off. Keep printing. So Corey DeAngelis, he's a policy wonk. His focus is education reform. I met him a few months back. Homeschooling isn't an experiment. People were learning at home for thousands of years. Factory schooling is the experiment, and the experiment is in trouble. So this is Family Guy spoofing North by Northwest, the Hitchcock classic, the plane, the duopolies. Endless resources, and then Peter Griffin or Cary Grant, as I probably prefer it. Independents trying to run for office, so Democrats, Republicans make it hard for libertarians to get on the ballot. So this is from Office Space. I'm sure, some of you guys have seen this movie. If you don't like the government, why don't you just leave? No way. Why should I leave? They're the ones that suck. I've actually told people that. That's why don't you leave? So you got Thanos with the communist, whatever thingy majig glove that he has. When you ask a Marxist to solve the issue of incentives, pricing theory, and the local knowledge problem, basic human nature that always caused social economies collapse, reality can be whatever I want. I don't even know that's how Thanos sounds. I've only seen the movie once. I'm just guessing. Here's a funny meme. A photographer took pictures of the people before and after she told them the commune already has a poet. So they're all happy. Uh-oh, they got to go to work now. Reynolds wrap, tinfoil, free hat in every box. I'm sure some people here at the college today probably have some of these. Got communist guy who says, I will lead the revolution just like Comrade Lenin. Can I get a, to which the McDonald's guy says, are you going to order something or just stand there and cry? So this is Buff Doge Dog. We might see Doge Dog later throughout the night. Sorry, but ATF agents are allowed to enter here. I guess that Doge Dog is St. Peter. That's interesting. I'm going to have to take that to Catholic Church.
It's a great argument for atheism right there.
I'll be right back.
I don't want
back.
That guy in the afterlife, man.
Here's another funny meme.
This has been going on for more than an hour.
Do you want to keep going or what? I'm having fun.
No. No. It's repetitive and meaningless, essentially, as far as I'm concerned. But we can get into that later.
All right. I'm having a good time, but let me wrap it up with one meme. I was actually almost finished, quite honestly. I only had a few more to go.
More memes.
Charlie, Tim, what's the verdict on?
It's up to you, Justin. You got an hour. We started at 6:15. Why don't you try to give it about 10 minutes and we'll wrap everything up. Would that be enough time, you think?
I'm down with 10 more minutes. Is everybody else down with 10 minutes?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll go 10 more minutes and then we'll let go into questions and answers. Okay.
All right. Thanks. All right. So here you have the 10-year challenge. We've seen some of these memes tonight. 2010s, somebody's growing weed there. 2020, the 2020s, somebody's mining crypto. Keep America clean. Throw the Democrats and Republicans in the trash. You got Elwood Blues. I hate Illinois Nazis. Anti-fascist Elwood Blues.
Joliet Jake, I think.
Oh, yeah. Joliet Jake. Thanks, Adam. My bad. So the guy, so I applied in like April of 2020 for my FOID card. I think it's only supposed to take like 90 days, maybe. It took me till May of 2021 finally get my void. You know why? Because this guy down at the Secretary of State's office was processing that. Don't tread on me. The dollar bill is all scrunched up there. So here. All right, so you have this pipe, and the pipe is the profit generated by the workers at Ingalls Family's factory mill, and it's being fed into Karl Marx's mouth, and the little drops on the side are the mill workers that Marx is writing about. So this angry little flower, Marx's attitude towards capitalists when they're writing about him. Marx's attitude when capitalist, when he's asking them for money. So there is a course. I'm not sure where this is being taught, but it's the consequences of capitalism. It's $300. Noam Chomsky charging $300 for a consequences of capitalism, of course. The linguistics professor and anti-capitalist critic is charging $300 to tell you about the negative consequences of capitalism, which can be yours for $300. You guys got until January 28th to enroll. Don't tread so close to me. I like to share this meme, or at least whenever I can remember to share it. Have a Gary happy birthday, Gary Johnson. So there's a dog decked out in commie gear, USSR. Me proceeds to eat something. My dog comes up like a communist. Yo, where's my food? So you're walking down an alleyway with a gram of weed in your pocket. Who would you rather catch you, Batman or Kamala Harris? Batman, I can guarantee you, does not care about the gram of weed in your pocket. But Kamala Harris, she wants to throw you in a cage. You got Soviet Santa, who comes to redistribute your gifts, takes the train. That is the most patriotic sunset I have ever seen. Ooh. Spike Cohen, a nation with the highest per capita rate of imprisonment has no business calling itself the land of the free. It's time to end the war on drugs, the war on sex work, and all other wars on victimless crime. Dare to mind your own business, Karen. So this is Bernie again, only give me your effing wallet. So you know that one guy who never buys and he just smokes all your stuff? I am once again asking if you can put it out now and let me keep the roach. I am no longer asking. So this is me, Adam, and Dave Kaufman from December of 2020. Open Illinois responsibly. Our first demonstration out there in front of the mayor's house. You got one of these guys. But he was whining in his system. Racism is simply an ugly form of collectivism. Mindset that views humans strictly as members of groups rather than individuals. That's Ron Paul paraphrasing Ayn Rand. This one's small, you probably can't read it, but it's Russell Means, who was the great Native American activist and actor. He also ran for the LP nomination in 88 and lost to Ron Paul. I want to be free. It's easier for me to be free it's easier for me to be free if you're free. So this is Bernie standing next to Lennon and what's his face? Trotsky, right after the revolution. So this is race mixing is communism. This is like Trump supporters all grown up now. Wrong in the communism. Oh, communism. Oh, everything. Cook County solar eclipse tax. There will be a solar eclipse viewing tax for all persons who viewing the eclipse in Cook County. All viewers will be assessed $1 per percent of sun coverage viewed, and additional $1 per viewer if solar glasses are used. So this is a meme that's got a lot of sentimental value to me. And I always read, when I read this meme, I always think my good friend Erica. I read it in her voice, and it's going to go like this. Sorry for what I said while being libertarian. And porcupine is the symbol of libertarianism in the United States.
Time for questions.
Let's see here.
Time for questions.
Let's see. Is it time for questions, or do we want to do more memes?
I think maybe it's now getting to the point where we're starting that the crowd's going to get hang on, Justin.
All right, that's fine. I just got more. There's so many more. I'll share more for my rebuttal. But okay. Thanks, guys. I will call it a night.
All right, then I guess we're ready to start. Ready to take them. I got some big ones, but I'm going to kind of keep
on. I have a question.
Go right ahead and start right away.
Okay. You say Ayn Rand says criminals and the government are the enemy. Why do you run for the government then? Aren't you being a hypocrite? And isn't that just rhetoric? Just more rhetoric. Thank you. I'll wait for my answer.
I don't think she actually said they were the enemy, but I don't think she actually called them the enemy. Maybe we're hypocrites, whatever. I don't think, I'm not an anarchist. I believe in democracy. so I don't think that I'm being hypocritical by running people for office. I mean, you can't deny that gangs and the government operate very similarly, both use similar tactics. Just pointing that out does not mean that you think that you know, the government that you hate, that you automatically should, is you're anti-government, but it's, you, if you observe how they behave, it's very similar. And Rand was just pointing that out. I don't think she ever called them the government the enemy. She was not an anarchist. So I think you misquoted the meme earlier, but I think I answered your question.
Judson, may I add something? The guy who helped me run the college for years, Bernie Sanders, as staunch libertarian, always opposed the running of any sort of candidates for office.
Was I heard Bernie's that for last 10 name years.
Who did that?
No, you. That was the senior moment. You meant Slim Brundage or someone
no,
else.
No, no, no. Bernie Summers was his name.
Bernie Summers.
That's more like it.
All right.
Senior moment.
Okay. Ryan, you got your hand up. Take the next question.
Yeah. Like, libertarians got some pretty funny memes. I mean, if you've been around the Facebook social media for a long time, have you found any socialist memes that are any, you know, any good, you know, make you laugh? And what is it? What is the fascination with the Libertarian Party and communism?
Like,
it seems kind of a straw man, like, because communism, like, there's a few communists, but you know, socialism or authoritarianism, I think, you know, is closer to what, you know, our reality. And, you know, so this, you know, this fixation on communism just seems like you're straw man in some.
Okay, that's fair. I have seen some really good leftist memes, but I didn't save any, and I didn't present them here. There's a meme that goes by the left can't meme. If you heard that one, the left can't meme. I actually don't believe that. I think Bernie Sanders did some really good memes during his 2016 campaign. I think his social media presence, he was putting out memes like almost every day, and it was just him saying a platitude. And I think that, like, you know, drilling in his policy planks, I think were pretty effective. And I followed that. And even those memes got parodied, and those parody memes became things within of themselves. I think a lot of libertarians do have like kind of McCarthyist tendencies that think that anything left of anarcho-capitalism is like communism. So I agree with that criticism. The memes tonight, though, I'm sharing were more for laughs and to trigger the commies here at the college, and they're funny. So I wanted to, I wanted to laugh. But I do agree with you. I think that a lot of libertarians, you know, have a knee-jerk reaction, think anything that the government does at all is communism. I think I agree with you. It's almost McCarthyist in a way.
All right.
Okay, who's next? All right, Justin, I just finished a book by Sebastian Younger, and it's called Freedom. And, you know, it's a book about a guy who was walking along the railroad tracks with his friends, and he actually does a good job of what defining freedom is. You know, he says freedom can be one thing, freedom from all government control, but then you also have to, you know, get together with others, be part of a group to kind of survive sometimes. But he also
says, your microphone is really bad, Tim. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's worse.
I thought he was losing his voice. Are you okay?
No, it's
the mic.
Interference.
Okay.
No.
Okay, I'm still able to hear the gist of Tim's question, and I can repeat it back to you guys. Okay, so Tim asked about a book called Freedom, and you said it defines freedom. What was the question?
The thing is, he defined freedom, you know, in a number of ways, but he said one definition was being going out by yourself and being without complete government control. But in the offset, he said you also have to be dependent upon others in a group in order to help yourself survive. And he said sometimes freedom can be the balance between choosing between a group of individuals and the government. I'd like to find out what your thoughts are on that question.
I agree with a lot of what you say. You can't have markets. Like, I think Rand gives gives libertarians a, you know, like her stance on, you know, almost like, self-reliance, be as self-reliant as you can. I think because Rand's kind of hyper-individualistic stance kind of gives libertarians that stereotype. And I say that libertarianism is not about being the most hyper-individualistic, self-reliant person. Although you can do so if you want to live that kind of lifestyle, nothing's stopping you from being a hermit. But also libertarians believe in markets, and it's hard to have a market if you don't have people coming together and making voluntary cooperative decisions that are mutually beneficial. So I agree with a lot of what you kind of described it as. And I Googled him as you were first mentioning him, and I've seen his documentary, Restrepo. I've seen that documentary. It's really good. And I have the other one, and I didn't realize he had more after those, but I have the other one in my Netflix queue. So I'm interested in learning more about this guy's book after, you know, his documentary. It's about Afghanistan, combat in Afghanistan. It's a pretty good documentary. Restrepo, Sebastian Younger, is that how he says his name?
Yes. He makes a really good, this is my first time encountering his work, and the book Freedom gives a good balance between his walk along the railroad tracks, and being free with a group of men. And then he goes into a lot of historical narrative about what it's like to be free, you know, about some of the violence and that can be in there, and the empires, and, you know, a lot of bit about the hunter-gatherer societies and how they govern. But there's always, you know, he always often says you can't really be free because you always have to have some element of cooperation. And he says how much or how little is what goes on. And he said, you know, that kind of thing. Anyway, I didn't mean to divert too much, but I just thought you'd like to be familiar with his work. I think it'd be right up your alley, Justin. All right, our next question, I don't know if we'll go Margaret, and then we'll go Gian Lee. So Margaret, please go ahead.
Okay, I would like specifically, you seem to differ a little bit with some of the doctrinaire libertarian things, but I would like to know specifically your opinions and why you hold them on public education.
Why do libertarians hold the positions they do on public education?
Yeah, or okay. your opinions are, because okay.
My personal opinion is, I mean, I think not all public schools are horrible, I went to a pretty decent public school, and there's a lot of community participation on how the school run. Are we going to vote for bonds? Are we going to vote on tax increases? I think I like charter school. I like the charter school thing. I think that vouchers is another good thing. If you are going to have public education, it should be as most controlled locally as you can by people in the community who have kids in the school, Preferably the schools will not make any sort of agreement with the teachers union, because as you can see, teachers unions in Chicago have really the schools haven't gotten any better. The people are leaving the school, the school enrollment's going way down. Too many strikes. If you have a right to a public education and you're going on and the teachers are going on strike, they're interfering with your right to an education. So I believe education choice. If you should be given the option to go to vouchers for a public school. I think that local school districts should also give charters, as the Chicago Public School does, to say to Noble Charter School Networks. And you'll see that libertarians have a wide range of opinions, even some of the most extreme ones to be abolish all public education. So why we have those stances, why do we have those stances? Well, we think that we do want kids to succeed. So we want our schools to be good, and we want to have the best education possible. And government schools have a virtual monopoly on the education system. And
read this name.
I couldn't.
Are arguably not educating kids properly. So
you know what, but who would like to learn? Even sometimes public school maybe not the best here. I don't know, I have no idea. But what I heard, but who would like to learn? Then people learn, and students learn, and kids learn. Who
do you monitoring this?
Huh?
I'm monitoring it. I just
No, who want to learn, they learn, and they're asking questions.
But you're not next.
Yes.
Okay. I have a question. My question is, I want to know, what do you think libertarians' view of the role of the government? More specifically, tell us three things that if a libertarian candidate is going to win, what are the three top priorities that they will set, so we understand if they are good or not for running the government, because you are saying that they are better alternatives. So what, according to your understanding, libertarians, what's the role of the government, and what three top priorities that they will set for how to run?
So the role of government is to protect the rights of the people and to administer true justice.
That's very abstract. To be more specific,
top three. All right, you asked kind of a multi-pronged question, so yes. Yeah, I'll get there. So that's the that's in the abstract, the ideal. What government should do if it is to exist. The priorities for, if you're talking political candidates, priorities vary from office to office. But just let's say for US president, smaller government, freer economies, more personal freedom, I think is a good three things. But if you're talking, there's no specific policy prescription that are like, all right, first we're going to do criminal justice reform, and then we're going to cut taxes. And there's no top three of anything like that. But I hope that might answer your question, or at least give you a better understanding of where we come from.
What you said is very like a traditional Republicans agenda. There's nothing new about how you're different from traditional Republican agenda. It sounds same.
Well, also, well, Republicans will talk a small government game. When was the last time the Republicans actually shrank government? The Libertarian actually believes in shrinking government. You know, if Republicans will say that they're for freedom, but they still, many of them still support locking up people for drugs or prostitution. A lot of Republicans want to take out books and libraries, which I don't support. I went to a public school in our library. Like, I don't care if there was naughty books in the library because, you know, because I took those books out, you know, and that if public schools kind of suck, but like, you know, I hate high school was kind of a bummer, but like, hey, you know, if I'm going there, at least I can read some Stephen King or something. But you know, like the Republicans also will say they're for law and order and, you know, rule of law and constitution. But after January 6th, a lot of them kind of like sympathize with what happened. And you know, kind of are still kind of, or don't think it's a big deal. Republicans, for many years wanted to only let, you know, restrict, you know, narrow govern, you know, basically they would only wanted government to only recognize marriage contracts, covenants between male and female people. They want to expand, you know, the right to contract to same-sex parties for a marriage covenant. So Republicans contradict, you know, go against a lot of their small government rhetoric.
Okay. All right. We got Charles Paydock. We got Bob Matter, Margaret, and then Brian. Okay, Charlie, you're next.
Okay, Justin. You had a meme early in the beginning that no law should be passed unless it has application to everyone in the United States.
Now, application to what in the United States?
Does not have application to everyone in the United States. Now, I do not live in Tornado Alley, nor do I live in a floodplain, nor do I live along a coast where there are hurricanes. So should I be opposed to disaster emergency relief for people who suffer these natural disasters, such as they had recently?
There may be a little.
Are you opposed to helping people in these situations, your party?
Of course, I'm not opposed to helping people in these situations. But should the government be doing it? Maybe in the state of Florida.
Die? I should just let them die?
One full at a time, Charlie.
Well,
are you going to let me talk, Charlie? I'm not answering your question. Are you going to keep interrupting me?
Go ahead.
Okay. So, you know, maybe in Florida, you have a hurricane comes through. Maybe government, you know, state of Florida disaster plan. I'm sure maybe those plans are popular with the people in those states. I don't know if people in Florida are advocating their government get rid of, you know, emergency relief, or even like, say, you know, local governments like, you know, Volusia County or Miami-Dade County, maybe got some sort of thing going. I don't know. But should I have to pay for the flooding? Somebody who lives in a house next on the Mississippi River and their house floods every 2-3 years and they get a, you know, do I have to keep giving them money to keep rebuilding their house? Probably not. But I mean, I don't, you know, if we're going to have disaster relief, it should probably be controlled locally and administered locally, and that sort of thing. Of course, I think we should help people have disaster relief. But I don't think it, you know, we the federal government is printing off money because it can't do all it can do with the money it just collects through taxes alone. So I don't wouldn't trust them to do disaster relief, nor can they afford to do it right now. So we should empower states to do that sort of stuff.
So we should just pretend it didn't happen. Say, well, it's up to you guys.
No, that's not what we... Right? I don't think any libertarian has ever said, let's not pretend that it didn't happen.
It's not up to me. Not up to me. Not my
Charlie,
problem.
Charlie, there'll be another round of questions, so you can ask another question.
All right.
I've got a question.
Blowing me off.
Okay, Ellen, you're Bob Matter, and then we'll go to you, and then since Margaret's already had one and Brian's already had one, we'll get them next. Now, Bob, you already had a question, right? Okay, Bob Matter, if you're there, go ahead.
Okay, Justin, so I wanted to know what Mr. Flynn died of, you know, so early. And then my other part of my question is, I noticed a lot of these memes had things like, you know, justice for George Floyd and Black Lives Matter and all this, and it's, you know, coming down on the police immunity, you know, kind of an anti-police rhetoric. And has the Libertarian Party gone woke?
I don't know what you mean by woke. To answer your question about Josh Flynn, I think he had several health issues, and I think specifically he may have had a heart condition. And if I'm incorrect,
that's correct. He had
please correct
trouble
me.
For years. He'd had trouble for years, unfortunately, with his heart problems.
Oh, that's too bad. That's terrible.
It was very tragic. It was sad. He had gone out to get something in his garage. Had been several minutes. His wife wondered where he was at. She sent his son out, and his son found him collapsed, and it's very sad, and we miss Josh a lot. To answer your questions, or has we gone woke? I don't know what that means.
Endorsing all this critical race theory.
I don't think I ever, when did we endorse critical race theory in this presentation?
Well, you had this justice for George Floyd, justice for Breonna Taylor, the anti-police rhetoric,
okay,
against the police immunity, all that kind of stuff, the BLM, you know, all that stuff.
Okay, well, that's not critical race theory. But anyways, to answer your question, so being against qualified immunity is not the same as being anti-police. Qualified immunity has been a doctrine that has been abused by police to basically free them of any consequences of any malpractice of their duties. So being against qualified immunity is not anti-police. Being against the police. Kneeing somebody, putting their knee on somebody's neck and obstructing their breathing, all because he passed allegedly passed a counterfeit bill, I think is a no-brainer.
He was resisting arrest. He was also overdosing on fentanyl.
Well, overdosing and resisting arrest and passing counterfeit bills is not
they were restraining him until the you know, so you got a guy like you got, you know,
this is one fool at a time. Are you going to want me to answer your question or are you going to keep interrupting me?
Well, go ahead.
Okay. So if somebody is high on drugs and resisting arrest and passing a bill, a fake bill, that does not give the police the ability to to murder him. They can have restrained him without.
Bummer.
He'll I'm sure Justin will be back online in a minute.
Justin, you're muted.
Yeah, no, he froze.
It's because we're back. So all this stuff is all this stuff should be no-brainers for libertarians. I don't think that that's endorsing. I don't see why it's controversial to think that George Floyd shouldn't have had died, or that Breonna Taylor shouldn't have died. Black.
Are you froze again?
We may have trouble with him in a minute or two. He'll be okay. You know.
Matter the organization, yes. Disagreements. The mantra's fine. That all of this is not an endorsement of critical race theory. And I don't know if that, you know, that I don't know what woke means in your sense. I think woke is just a you know.
At least one or two of the memes was saying it's not enough to be anti-racist. You have to be, being against racism is not enough. You have to be an anti-racist or something like that.
I mean, libertarians can be as racist or anti-racist as they want, but if you're going to have an organization that wants growth and wants to appeal to mass people, being, you know, being at, you know, and a lot of racism's perpetuated by government, I think it makes a lot of sense to come, you know, to be positively anti-racist. I don't see why that's controversial either.
Sounds like you're endorsing identity politics.
What does that even mean?
And I noticed in some of the photographs there was a lot of
identity politics
flags, and there was some stuff about, you know, trans rights, and then also about, you know, stuff about pro-immigration. You know, it's a lot of this just seems like the Libertarian Party has just been taken over by wokesters.
Actually, these are libertarian positions going back 50 years. None of this is, nobody's been, have you been in the Libertarian Party? Have you been to Libertarian Party meetings? If you've never known.
Mises quotes are from the 1920s about immigration.
Yeah, these go back.
Yeah, well, I know they've always been soft on immigration, you know, of course, now it's more of a hot button issue. People didn't think much about it back in the 50s and 60s because it was more or less kind of a small thing and controlled, but now it's gone completely haywire. And if the Libertarian Party is going to be taking this pro-immigration status, they're going to be really shooting themselves in the foot, because it's one thing that the American electorate is against. It's all this mass immigration and uncontrolled immigration that we have. We have really an invasion going on. I'd call it more of an invasion.
You can save this for your rebuttal, and we can move on to other people's questions.
Okay. Ellen didn't have a question yet. I'd like to her to go next, and then Margaret will get you, and then Brian will get you, okay, if you don't mind. Go ahead, Ellen.
Right. Thanks, Justin. And I'm becoming more libertarian than I used to be because of the mandate. They've done a good job of pushing me to the libertarian and away from democracy. But the thing that I used to be kind of a libertarian, but my concern was, if you looked at how it played out, it seemed like deregulation of business, like Milton Friedman was calling for, you know, monetarism, it ended up leading to what we have is a monopoly, you know, especially I'm worried about the media monopoly that, you know, you can have an echo chamber that basically is going to lead to this duopoly.
What's your question?
The limits on you. So I guess, how are you going to deal with this? I mean, I'm trying to think, if you look at the last 40 years, you know, what good has, I mean, how have you been successful? I mean, there's a lot of cute memes, and, you know, I hope you could, I don't know, maybe somebody could stop the mandates if they could operate at the local level. But I just find it so depressing. I'm 66 years old, and I've never been so depressed about, it's like, wow.
Leviathan.
And so, okay, you can talk libertarian, but can you do it? You know, is it going to work? I mean, I don't see how it's working. If anything, maybe you've got, you know, Clinton in there trying to talk, you know, small government. But in reality, they were over there doing dirty CIA stuff all along. How can we get rid of this deep state, this deep corruption? Just calling it deregulated isn't going to work, you know, because they're evil. How do you stop them being evil?
All right. So first off, the government has not deregulated much of anything. If anything, regulations continue to be added on.
My hand is getting numb.
And I'm talking about
the financial, the banking. They deregulated the banks with the Glass-Steagall, say.
Okay. All right. How do we stop monopolies? I think a lot of monopolies are government imposed, government maintained. Certain monopolies exist just because they had the infrastructure in place, and you know, like utilities, for example, tend to be monopolistic just by nature of how they operate.
Say police, the big jails, big police. You know, does Lori Lightfoot given 1,000 more police just to prove what a great law and order?
So the police, you know, they're making a government monopoly on force. Mm-hmm. So the police is not run by any private deregulated entity. The police do such a piss poor job of stopping crime here in Chicago that in Bucktown they started hiring private security to monitor the neighborhood, and I think that's been going on in other neighborhoods for a long time before that. So
you just hired more for no
you reason. Asked like a bazillion questions. I don't remember them all. I answered at least a couple of them, so we'll move on to the next next question.
How can we stop this police state? You know, I mean, some good ideas,
we can repeal a lot of laws that require the police to have their nose in it anyway. We can reprioritize what we do. We can get rid of qualified immunity, that sort of thing.
Where is the police state?
Yeah, qualified immunity would be a perfect one. I agree with that. Actually,
who's got the next question?
Can I ask a question, please, since I'm next in the line here?
All right.
Thank you. Will you please address the public health versus individual rights? And when do public health mandates, if they are considered necessary by public health authorities and by physicians, when do people's individual rights come into play? You know, I'm thinking about the COVID thing, obviously, but it has to do with our national response to contagious infectious diseases for the last 100 years since we figured out that bacteria and viruses cause disease, that bacteria were pathogenic. We realized that we could get diseases from bacteria, and bacteria could be.
So you asked the question,
in your opinion, when do we ever use government mandates to prevent the spread of infectious disease? That's my question.
I would say a reasonable one would be if the infection rate is higher than, or if the death rate is. Don't get me wrong, COVID is serious. Some people have died. Some people are dealing with a lot of after effects. But for the vast majority of the population, it is not as severe. Usually people who die from it have certain attributes that contribute. I think a lot of the deaths have maybe been inflated because they probably test you when you die and you're in there for something else. I think if we're going to have any sort of emergency response, it should probably be done at the most local of levels. It probably should be the most democratic way possible. Lori Lightfoot has, I guess, emergency powers that the city council gives her, which is how I think they justify these mandates. But I think that they're not justified because I don't think that it's as deadly. And we know how it operates. We could do things, you know, I, you know, right along Milwaukee Avenue near where I live, people were already voluntarily asking for papers to get in. You know, people can socially distance, people can make choices, people can, you know, there's still a lot of options available for people who are at risk to prevent illness that do not require mandates or shutting down the economy or that sort of thing.
All right, next.
I think if it was a deadlier disease, yes, maybe, you know, if it's much deadlier disease, but maybe there could be more action. I don't think that the action that we have now from this disease justifies what we got.
Can I ask
and the Supreme Court and others.
After Charlie, have... Lana.
After no, Charlie. Brian.
Brian and Charlie and Lana. Okay, Brian, go ahead.
Call me next. Let me think about my question because I'm processing what Justin just said.
Okay.
Then. All right, I'll go.
What? All right, Charlie, go ahead.
Yeah, Justin, I can travel anywhere I want, anytime, across the nation if I want. I can move wherever I want. I basically can say whatever I want. I can assume any occupation that I feel like. Now, a central feature of almost all your minds and the central issue of the Libertarian Party is this anti-government. Well, where's all the, what in the world are you talking about? I was a volunteer for the civil liberties people here for years, and we had some issues, but there's no worth of totalitarian oppression that this should be the central and only feature of your political organization. I have to pay taxes. Big deal. I get services in return. I just went to the alley and
what's your
I saw question some again? Guys take out the garbage. So
what's your question?
I gotta pay for them. What's the big deal? Is the same message for 25 years? Where's the totalitarian state?
It's right now. It's the state that forced businesses to close and it's the state that put people who are infected with the virus in nursing homes in the most vulnerable populations.
Can't carry a gun without all kinds of damn red.
Is that the best you got? Come on.
Did I answer your question, Charlie?
No.
What was your question again?
I want to know where this evil government is.
Oh yeah, I think it's like everywhere,
police.
Charlie.
When I see police, I feel very nice. I like them.
By the way, hey, I honestly don't think it's completely evil or completely good.
Old white guy in Bridgeport
big
likes
and bloated and does
wow. I don't like them. They save senior citizens from getting, you know, by. Yeah, they're
well,
all right.
Libertarians aren't anti-police. They just want the police to be just and to not abuse their authority.
I mean, I asked for more police
right.
on public transit. According to you, that would have been crazy.
When did I say that?
Well, you're anti-police. All your minds are anti-police, anti-police.
Qualified immunity, Anton.
Yeah, that's not true, Charlie. I think I already explained this one in an earlier question. I can move on to the next question now.
Let's move on. Okay, Brian, you're
right. That doesn't explain anything.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. Brian, go ahead.
No, so Charlie, as usual, is, you know, conflating issues and misrepresenting the Libertarian Party. But, you know, it's how he is. You know, like, I'm not anti-police or and I think I'm not anti-government. I think the government plays a necessary role in society. Like, one of my issues with the COVID response is that they used a blanket one size fits all approach to the problem. It's like the only solution is the vaccine. That's it. And, you know, that doesn't take into account that people of varying ages and varying risk factors have almost no risk at all from COVID. You know, why should they expose themselves to the risk of this vaccine, which is you know, experimental as of what, 6 months ago. And now it's like everybody in the world over five has to get it. Like, this is crazy. And, you know, I'm not, you know, questioning like the government's authority, like local authority. Hey, Lori Lightfoot, you know, I would suspect under our, the interpretation of our laws, that she has the authority to do what she's doing. Well, should she do it? Absolutely not. I mean, this is nuts. And it really appalls me that people are accepting this. Like, what's next? That, you know, you're gonna need three jabs to go to a restaurant unless, you know, if you're five and up, when, you know, within 3 or 4 weeks, this virus is expected to be over. Like, we're all supposed to get COVID here next couple of weeks. Hey, I mean, it's and we're mandating people to get these jabs that's going to affect their immune systems. For
what was your question again?
We don't even know.
Hey, Margaret, the pandemic is over.
Oh, good. I can go out and run around.
Yeah.
Dennehy, what was your question again?
Well, I didn't really have a question.
Yeah, well, you're gonna, we have the rebuttal period for all of that. So wait until later.
Okay, Lana, you had a question, so go ahead.
Yeah, very quick. Can you educate me? I would like to know if Libertarian or you particularly support.
They got what they needed instead of just forcing this other thing.
No.
No, you're. Can you hear me?
Can you hear me? So, I would like to know, Justin, what you particularly, you support Bernie Sanders for for free education and free medical care in this country. And the second question, very quick, what do you think about vaccination? It's supposed to be voluntarily mandate or controversial? That's what my two questions.
Okay, so do I support universal health care?
Yeah, yeah.
No, I do not.
Why?
Because government's already doesn't need, so government now manipulates the market,
mm-hmm.
and wastes a lot of money and mm-hmm. drives up the cost of health insurance,
mm-hmm.
and healthcare in general. So I think that, I mean, maybe there is a way that you can, you know, administer something on a very small level, similar to how European countries do it, but even those mm-hmm. aren't, even those countries are running deficits too.
What about
you had can you let me finish, please?
Oh,
so and then you have places like Vermont, where Bernie's from. I think then they try to do a state plan that didn't work. So there's that. And then you asked about vaccinations. I am against, you know, the government saying that you have to get vaxxed. I am against the government saying that businesses have to inspect vaccination status for them to enter in, unless those businesses mm-hmm. unless they want to exclude the non-vaccinated from their own private property, they should have the right. I think that business owners have the right to set standards if they feel that a vaccination is good for their business. You don't have a right to work at a.
Yeah, but what about private citizens? Private citizens, whoever.
Yeah, if you don't want, if you don't want to have to get a jab, which some people call it, you don't have to get one. And if somebody's forcing you to get one under threat of fine or prison time or something like that,
losing your job,
nobody threatened me, but you
well,
know,
well, going to school is one thing, but I mean, private employers
can't teach,
it's controversial,
but schools are public, so it's a little different. And I think that teachers, and you know, should have a little more flexibility, but
can't be a nurse,
but private people should be should have standards for if they feel that it's necessary, because vaccinations do seem to help people.
Bioweapons. And it's all kept out of the
one full at a time, please.
Yeah, I'm agree, Ellen.
But I don't want to put a gun to anybody's head and say take the vaccination. I think it should be done voluntarily.
Right.
I personally would not want, you know, I might disagree with businesses who check your papers at the door or want to force their employees, but as owners of their private property, okay, they can exclude people from it if they choose.
Right. What if some people...
So you already asked a question. You asked it. I answered it. Is there more people who want to ask questions?
One more. I just want to say, what do you think about free education in this country? I mean, in colleges, not...
I already asked that question. You already answered that question.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Okay, all right. All right. Anybody else has a question we haven't heard from? Have anything you'd like to ask real quick?
I've got, what do you think about packing the Supreme Court?
It's a bad idea. If anything, we should fix the Supreme Court with the amount of judges it has now.
But isn't it right wing? What about Roe versus Wade? You think that could go?
What about it?
Huh?
What about it?
They're going to overturn it. Do you think that you have the right to do that based on states' rights or the way it's been manufactured in Texas?
I'm not sure. I think Roe versus Wade, that's a 14th Amendment issue, if I'm not mistaken. I personally have never read the Constitution and thought that there was like a right to an abortion there, but I'm not, you know, courts have interpreted that there is. I personally, I think that abortion should be a choice for women in most instances.
Depending on what state you live in?
Federal, there's local, so you know, people in one state might think it's immoral and may want to outlaw it and not think it's a right. But as the law is now, there's a baseline for it. I don't know what's going to happen. But even if they were to say, you know, states could also, and I'm sure states already do have this maybe in their laws already that the you know, like Illinois, very, very liberal abortion laws. And I'm if it's at the state level, you're certainly going to still have states that are pro-choice. And even libertarians are divided on that issue. So you just asked a question. Right, I answered it. Is there anybody else?
I wanted to add something to it.
You can do rebuttals later.
Okay, let's
like add something.
If anybody else have a pressing question or not? Because I'd like to go to rebuttals now. I'd like to give everybody about 4 to 5 minutes on the rebuttals. Who's got a rebuttal that they'd like to talk about? I'll take down.
Let's thank our speaker.
Yeah, you're right, Charlie. Let's thank our speaker first.
Hey.
All right, so
hey.
I'm not going to rebut tonight because I've got too many points to make, but you know, I'm also more in agreement with Justin on most of the libertarian things he's doing. So who would like to rebut? Margaret, you got one?
I'll rebut.
All right, and then Ellen?
I'll let Ellen go first.
Okay, then, all right, who else?
I'll give you one.
All right, Bob, you'll go third. Charlie, you want to do one?
Yeah.
Okay, anybody else?
I'll do one too, Tim, please.
Okay, yeah, all right, 5A. Who else? We got 5 speakers so far.
I'll go.
Who?
I'll go, Brian.
Brian, okay, so that's 6. If you guys don't mind, I'll give you guys about 4 minutes each. It might be a little bit after 9, but I think it'll be a good one. All right, so the order I've got is Ellen, Margaret, Bob, Charlie, Adam, and Brian. Anybody else while I've got this line down? Okay, Adam, you wanna go? You're number 5, okay?
Sounds okay to me.
You're number 6. Charlie, you're number 4. Bob, you're number 3. Ellen, you're number 1. Margaret, you're number 2. Let me get a clock up here on my other computer so that I don't
Mr. Geis, what do you think? I'll give each of you guys about 4 minutes. I think that would be appropriate on the amount of time. So, Ellen, when you're ready, please go ahead and we'll get started.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you, Justin. Like I said, I think I agree with your premises more than in the past, mainly because the biggest threat I see right now is the mandated vaccines. And the fact is there's evidence that I've known for 2 years that this is a bioweapon that came out of Fort Detrick. It was, if you read the Kennedy book, you know, he's got so much data. Really, the CIA, an evil, corrupt Nazi CIA, FBI, it's always been there. It's just been hidden. And since the 40s, you know, and Nixon was kind of part of this, right? I recently saw that, and people, it's this uncovered hidden history that they've been able to, basically after World War II, we became the CIA is a Nazi force, a police force operating through our CIA, NSA. The National Security Act was written by Reinhard Gehlen, a Nazi, working with Dulles, who was a Nazi, and his brother. And but it's been covered up this whole time. And I don't know how we're going to get it exposed. Actually, Lyndon LaRouche's group has done a lot of good. That's why they stuck them in jail. But what we need is an uncorrupt government. And I think libertarians speak to that issue kind of, you know, in a way. But unfortunately, what we need is regulate businesses. I think the biggest damage has been the Citizens United, which was, all this has been manufactured by Nixon, Office of Legal Counsel, CIA, Department of Justice in 1981 under Reagan, you know, in the name of deregulation, probably. They're like, we will not investigate each other. We will, so that we can do Iran-Contra and, you know, bring in drugs and then just, you know, kill the people like Gary Webb who expose it. You know, any investigative journalism or Lyndon LaRouche, stick him in jail. I mean, just basic Nazi stuff that has to be stopped. And just, you know, voting and talking, nah, nah, nah. You know, it sounded good, but it hadn't worked. And we got to figure out, one, the right to the truth and history. And we have to prosecute. We have to prosecute criminal lawyers. That's why I like that qualified immunity. They actually, prosecutors have absolute immunity in the United States. They removed the honest services laws. They so that you can't make a case against a Justice Department who control each state separately, and then they're packed into the Supreme Court at every level. The Federalist Society has just packed their people in there, and you know, it's like, well, if you can't see it, you know, let's just not talk about it, make funny jokes and memes. But these guys are, this is a Nazi state. We need to, like, they need to put a little sign, I am a Nazi, you know, I don't know how else we're going to get denazify the country unless we talk about Nazis and fascists. And it's just not going to be libertarian yaya. And I think they've infiltrated, and it does come from Zionism, which is a form of Nazism, you know, through Italy and Rothschild and these guys. They have penetrated. Rahm Emanuel is the reason we have what Lori Lightfoot does, what she does. It doesn't matter who's in there, because the Cook County Democratic Party controls basically what's going to go on in the cities. And then at the bigger level, you got the Republican Governors Association. So they can go around doing their little issues, and it's just a puppet game. And I mean, so I think libertarians may be the only thing. I saw Naomi Wolf, who is working with Steve Bannon at the beginning. They found actually FOIA requests showing this was a plan at Wuhan. They knew they were making a weapon. They released it. The United States paid for it and released it in Wuhan and has covered it up. Okay, right, and that's why Charlie wanted to let me talk about it. But look at Naomi Wolf on Steve Bannon, and I mean, I can't believe that Steve Bannon is the only one telling the truth. But that's why I've become a libertarian too. It's weird, but and I know Thea, so I'm glad to see she's running. Okay,
all right, thanks. All right, thanks, Ellen. All right, Margaret, you're ready. 4 minutes.
I feel like anticlimactic. Anyway, I guess I always have had a natural resistance to libertarianism because, you know, they're against public health unless it serves them. They are against public schools unless it serves them. And it just, Justin was a little bit whoopee on the public school situation. He's for charter schools, which are actually not better than public schools when you consider that they can accept people that they don't want, that other places, or that they can get rid of students that are problem students or that require more resources, like disabled students and English language learners or have behavioral problems. All of those kids, the public schools have to deal with and have to provide resources. What our problem with public education here, why the schools are not really as good as they could be, is because they are underfunded and by the city, and underfunded by the state, and underfunded by the federal government. And so if we actually gave public schools the resources that they need to really do the jobs that they could that they need to do, and if we made it so that they had like one teacher for every 15 to 20 students, which is actually what's recommended, and then we would have excellent public schools. And some of the public schools within the Chicago public schools are excellent. Lincoln Park School is always on the top list of U.S. News and World Report for local high schools, always on the top 10. And so because of the number of AP classes that are available, because of the number of kids that go on to college, et cetera, et cetera. So, and that's not the only one that's on that list. But at any rate, if we did all the schools like that, and one of the reasons that the initial charter schools worked out is because they did the multi wraparound with social workers and specific science teachers and on an elementary level, on a primary school level, and all that other jazz, so that they really did do a wraparound of services that were necessary for the community that they were in. So of course they had good outcomes. In the Chicago public schools, we have one social worker for 1,000 to 1,500 students in problem schools in a poor neighborhood. You know, what the hell is that? That's not social work, that's crisis management at best. So, you know, this is not an appropriate use of our resources. This is not a fulfillment of the commitment that was made in the late 1800s and early 1900s to public education, which led to educated people so that they would be competent citizens. We cannot have competent citizens unless we have public education that's free and is available to everyone, and that's adequate education that meets standards, that does what it's supposed to. We cannot have a democratic society. So if we don't invest in public education, if we don't make sure that our governments do the appropriate investment in public education, we are not going to have a functioning democracy. And that's the way it's working out. Because since the Second World War, we've cut and we've cut and we've cut and we've cut things that in education. And for example, a judge like 30 years ago said that basing the money that public education gets on property taxes was totally unequal, was practically immoral, because there are rich communities and there are poor communities. So the kids that live up in Evanston and go to Evanston Township get a good education, But the kids that live down here and go to the schools on the in the south and west side, where the parents aren't can't be motivated because they're working two jobs or whatever is going on there, that they're not able to participate. And everybody wants good education for their kids, but people don't have the time and the energy to put in the political work that needs to be done frequently, or the knowledge either for that, for immigrants, right. And stuff, they don't have the knowledge. I'm against libertarians, and you didn't explain anything with your thing. You just said all this disconnected bullshit.
Okay. Still, what's wrong with the McGuffey reader in the one-room schoolhouse, but never mind. Margaret, thank you for rebutting.
Yeah.
All right, Bob, you're next.
Okay. So first, let's go back to that Ayn Rand quote. The full quote. The full quote is the two enemies of the people. I hear some hyena making noise. Tim, can you stop that?
Yeah, I can. I think we'll be all right.
Okay. The two enemies of the people are criminals and government. So let us tie the second down with the chains of the Constitution, so the second will not become the legalized version of the first. So that's the full quote. So in other words, and matter of fact, and that was a sort of a embellishment of something that Thomas Jefferson had said a couple hundred years earlier. He said something similar, essentially that, you know, we have to tie down the power of the government with the Constitution so that they don't, have this overreach that we see happening every day. Okay. And another thing we have to get over is the fact that the Constitution is silent on the subject of abortion. There's nothing in the Constitution that says you have a right to have an abortion. What the Constitution does protect life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And once that child is conceived, it is now a life, and now it has constitutional protections itself. And let's see the immunity business. These movements to weaken the immunity that police have, you know, are very worrisome. Now, fortunately, the Supreme Court ruled against those recently. But the thing is, with all the hype that we get from the Democratic media, you know, the anti-police hype, the lying, look how they lied during the Rittenhouse case. Just blatant lies that, you know, Rittenhouse was a active shooter murdering people. One report said he was murdering black people and he shot white people and it was in self-defense, but they have this all twisted around, and you know, this can affect juries. And unfortunately, the jury came out on the right side on the Rittenhouse case. But look at this poor white woman police officer that got recently was convicted of shooting this young black guy. She thought she had her taser, but she had her pistol out and shot him, and he got killed. Well, that was, you know, obviously an accident. It was on video, and it happened in this, you know, in the heat of the moment, again, when he was trying to resist arrest, and now she's going to prison. Now, she should be immune from that. And this, you know, by having this qualified immunity, this, you know, this gives people, you know, a little more, desire to become a policeman. Now, you may get sued when you're just carrying out your duties and trying to protect yourself. You know, you could get an overzealous, jury, prompted by media lies to convict you of murder. You know, who's going to want to be a policeman pretty soon? Look how cops are leaving the force, you know, like in Chicago and everything and everywhere else. When you're down on the ground, you know, rolling around with a suspect who's going for your gun, right, you have to depend on your partner being willing to shoot that guy, okay, and not go to prison or be, let's, you know, sued. You know, am I past my 4 minutes?
Yeah, you are about 4:25.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Just all right.
Well, anyway, thanks. Okay. Charlie, you're next.
All right, I'll be brief. We're running out of time. It's good to see you again, Justin. Thank you for your presentation. Good to see all you other libertarians come by more often. I've only got 3 issues because I think that's about all you guys might handle. But 3 very basic things. When the pandemic first took place, I was thinking to myself, what are the libertarians going to do? And there's nothing that illustrates the fallacy of libertarianism than a pandemic. It is illogical to do whatever you want and have any hope whatsoever of ending it. You cannot go anywhere in our society without engaging in interaction. And if you interact, you may contaminate others. I have difficulty going down the street because I may encounter, even going to the grocery store, I may encounter one of you fellow libertarians who doesn't like the mandate. Well, that restricts my civil liberties. There's an internal, you profess transmitting a disease as an act of violence, by the way, which you guys disavow, and you claim not to do no harm. Also, unvaccinated people, that's how the damn thing mutates, is one unvaccinated person gives it to another. Margaret could correct me on that. Number 2, once again, I see the Libertarian Party has absolutely no issues. You've been going around for 50 years. Every other party has a list of 10 issues in each campaign, but you guys have been rerunning the same ones over and over and over and over. I've got them memorized. It's the same thing, same cookie over and over. All right, no new issues. Number 3. You don't seem, I don't believe, and okay, I'm going to be critical. You're not engaged in valid political science. Society is confronted with problems. And it's a changing society over those years. Society changes and new problems arise. And there's a variety of solutions that should be undertaken to solve those problems. You seem to disregard that there are problems outside of, I don't know. Amazingly, you don't recognize the problem of gun violence. I can't figure out. There's mass shootings, man. And you advocate more guns. I've got to shake my head and wonder what's going on here. But no, you approach government with and sit down and say, yes, we do in fact have problems. We should do something about it. I'm not using any gauge of too much government and too less, but what is the appropriate thing to solve the problem in the quickest and most efficient method? Now that's genuine government. Now, that's what I mean. You failed the test, Chuck's test, with the pandemic by having that demonstration. They're giving out no mandates. Well, what are you, pro-pandemic? Come on, guys. That's what Raj would say. Come on, guys. Right, no Charlie. Mandates. So I have to go to a restaurant where the waitress may have COVID, doesn't wear a mask, and nobody else does. You say, oh, what? Oh, this is what you're advocating? No, thank you. All right, guys, good to see you again. Take care and come back when, when you thought about what I told you.
Okay, Adam, you're next. Adam Balling, you're next.
All righty. Sorry, I was finishing up the dishes. In the past, this is the problem. It's okay to be a devil's advocate, but it's not usually a good sales technique to be melodramatic when you're devil's advocate. I have heard, and Tim's YouTube channel has, past videos of Charlie opposing the existence of restaurants and a lot of straw man arguments with Dave Travis, if any of you remember that guy, that they're exploitative of labor, that, oh, you work all your life and you make some restaurateur rich and they don't pay you a living wage and don't pay you to retire. I didn't know he had such a love affair with the restaurant now, but that's okay. Times have changed maybe when we've been home a lot more for 2 years. I am vaccinated. If you want, I can get my card. I had just been off camera for a while, but I don't feel like I need to share that with you. But you really think that small businesses should get fined sometimes $10,000 at a time, Charlie? That's confiscatory. That is severely confiscatory. That is disproportionately punishing people who can't handle it. And also, you know that there's racial disparities in vaccination rates. So this falls very unevenly in our ethnically divided city. I heckled earlier that I'm not too surprised that an older white man living in Bridgeport is pretty uncritical of the police. So I'll skip that. And you know, older white guys from Bridgeport have done such a great job governing Chicago in the last century. And on that note, when it comes to government, since there's been a monopoly by the Democratic Party in Chicago since Tony Cermak was elected in 1931, there has been, with except a brief interruption in the 90s after the 1994 Republican wave, the state legislature has been a Democratic monopoly in Illinois for decades. You know, Charlie, if these things are so solvable, by all means, work your goddamn magic here in Illinois and do it already. You've had a century. Have you not had the time? Has your party that you say we should be loyal to not had the time? I had this argument with my parents on the right about the failure of the drug war. We've had 50 years since Nixon, or now, well, just a little over 50, because now it's 2022, since Nixon amped up what we know as the drug war. And you could go back to 1914 for that one if you wanted, with the foundation of the Bureau of Narcotics. Has it been a success? Do I get to declare it a failure after 50 years? And I know that Charlie's being a troll because Charlie's being a troll. So I don't really care too much about that for too many minutes. If you're interested in, you know, clean local government, Charlie, I mean, getting more parties on the ballot, just in general principle, you've got a Green Party sign on your wall, along with all the Democratic Party signs. I think that's something that you could support, even if you don't particularly cherish any of our free market libertarian message. In terms of some of Margaret's points, there was a documentary put out by Johan Norberg a few years ago looking at Sweden that talked about something there that would probably ruffle a few feathers all around the political spectrum in the United States, but they have both voucherized universal healthcare and voucherized education. And that's in what's considered by some a sort of social democratic paradise. And this is also true of school choice initiatives that have taken place in other left of center constitutional democratic countries, like New Zealand is one. It's often something you'll see in the smaller countries. And I'll say this on the other side of things, right of center, smaller countries, Ireland tried to outlaw abortion for, I believe, 36 years from the mid 80s or early 80s till the referendum a couple years ago to change their constitutional amendment. That's an overwhelmingly white, overwhelmingly conservative country. Didn't have a major center left party in their two-party system. And they were about as pro-life as you could be for Western Europe. And they did a 180. So I would say to anyone out there who has pro-life beliefs, if you think this hasn't been tried, look at the history of Ireland from the 1980s to the present. It has been tried. and it was found wanting by a nation that is about 80% Roman Catholic.
Okay.
And I say this is an Irish American and an ex-Catholic. Thank you.
I'm sorry about that. I got to silence the other guy on my. Okay, I'm sorry about that. All right, Brian, you're going to be next. Go ahead.
Be still. So I wanted to speak to the issue of the schools. I know Margaret had some complaints about the way that libertarians would handle public schooling. So I would say this, the libertarians, so I am a libertarian. I've run for office as a libertarian. I've adopted policy positions as a libertarian, policy positions that I thought were consistent with my own ethical, you know, personal ethical values and the libertarian platform. So, you know, my view of the public education system is that the social contract that we've adopted, you know, dictates that we fund public schools, public education for all the kids, you know, between a certain age. The social contract doesn't obligate me in particular, since I don't have any kids in the school system, to be involved in their education. I will fund it. You know, that's a portion of my property taxes goes to pay for the schools, and I'm fine with that. I'm happy that the kids in the city are getting educated, but the way it's being done, you know, through the public education system has been, you know, centralized control over public education, bunch of bureaucrats sitting around getting pensions and healthcare and making sure they spend their budget so they get more money next year. And, you know, the disparity in the Chicago public school system, as an example, you know, she talked about schools that were good. Well, how about the schools that are not so good? And there are plenty of those. So, you know, my libertarian solution would be acknowledge the social contract. I've agreed to, you know, to fund public education for the kids. Give the money directly to the parents, give them a voucher, let them spend it on education, let them spend it on food, let them spend it on clothes. I don't care. I don't want to be involved. I just want to know how much it's going to cost me. And because it's become this centralized control of public education and this bureaucracy and this union, now I'm involved in all this stuff. The kids ain't getting educated because so-and-so, you know, they want this rule. No, they don't agree with that rule. So the whole system's got to shut down, right? If you just give the money to the parents, they will educate their own kids. And I've met my, you know, the terms of the social contract that I've agreed to, right? I mean, this for the rest of this stuff where I've agreed to the, you know, Chicago Public Teachers Union and, you know, Lori Lightfoot have an executive authority. You got to do this. No, I didn't agree to all that crap. I don't want to be involved in that. So is that my time?
Oh, you still got another minute and a half left.
Yeah. So it's like the libertarian value system is based on the premise that anything the government has is taken from someone else involuntarily. Nobody, you know, like I agree to it, but, you know, like if I don't give it to them, they're going to come and put me in a cage and take all my stuff. Right. I mean, it's not like it's voluntary. And the way that, you know, my tax money is being spent, I just so disagree with it that I can't say it enough. And it's not that I don't acknowledge that there is a social contract to care for other people, even through government, because that's the system that we've adopted. And if the government needs to provide benefits to people because people would suffer without them, well, that's the system we have, right? And you can't just cut people off because it would be cruel, right? So, you know, it's, you know, these representations about what is a libertarian, I'm a libertarian, and I don't, you know, I agree that there is a social contract in place.
So. Okay, thanks a lot. That was our last rebutter. Is there anybody else who's got a rebuttal in them before I let
I wanted to give a rebuttal.
Go ahead, Ellen. You can go ahead.
Okay.
4 minutes.
Okay. I just wanted to talk about a couple of things. First of all, Bob, Matter, just so you know, pregnancy is considered implantation in the of the embryonic cells in the uterine wall. So if you feel like you have to protect an embryo after conception, you, you're gonna outlaw the pill and you're gonna outlaw IUDs, because the pill does not necessarily prevent conception. It prevents implantation in the uterine wall. And the IUD may also, I'm a little less clear about that. So I just want to mention that. I think that's, I find it very interesting that people want to control the bodies of women and want to force women to have children against their will, and then they want to be, then they don't want to pay for government services for the children who, because they were born unwanted, they have a lot of difficulties in life. And if you're so anti-abortion, I'm wondering where you stood. If you consider yourself pro-life, I wonder where you stood on the Iraq war and the Afghanistan war, which were both wars that I was opposed to. So I would say I'm a bit more pro-life than a lot of people, depending on how you consider pro-life. I consider being against wars where hundreds of thousands of people die. I consider that pretty pro-life. Okay, and I think, I'm really dismayed by the government's push for vaccine mandates. I think it's pretty obvious by now. I mean, as we speak, I know four people who were vaccinated, three of whom had boosters, all of them have COVID. I mean, everybody knows that tons of people have COVID who have been vaccinated, which means they are spreading it to other people. I don't think there's clear evidence that unvaccinated people spread COVID more than vaccinated people, because so many vaccinated people are getting COVID right now. Now,
that's
they may
wrong.
Just be mild.
That's wrong.
They may just
wrong.
Be mild.
Wrong.
Wait, it's my turn. One full at a time, Charlie.
No, not if you're not if no. You're
no, wait. One
advice.
Full at a
one
time.
One full at a time, Charlie.
No.
One full at a time.
Okay. If you get boosted or you may have a mild case, possibly, but that doesn't mean you're not spreading it to other people. So, these ideas, about forcing people to get vaccinated when they're going to spread it just as much as the unvaccinated.
No.
Fauci agreed with that. Look on the end of the Infinity book. Fauci agreed with that.
Very one full at a time. One full at a time.
Spreading the damn illness.
Let's let Ellen finish.
One full at a time.
Vaccinated. They all got COVID. I have a friend who got COVID who was vaccinated.
They're going to take cost somebody their life.
Charlie, you need to stop it.
I have a friend who got COVID, who was vaccinated and probably boosted, and she still passed away, okay? So, and she could have spread it to other people before she died, before she knew she had it, potentially, or when she was just beginning to develop COVID. And, you know, if you want to get vaccinated, good for you. You can do whatever you want with your life, you know? You know, or if you don't want to get vaccinated, I'm cool with that as well. The truth is that the biggest issue with the vaccines is just we do not know the long-term consequences of the vaccines. Now, I have been vaccinated, but I'm saying that is an issue. And to force other people vaccinated when we don't know. Usually vaccines go through like a 5 or 10 year trial period. And obviously these COVID vaccines, these specific COVID vaccines have not gone through a 5 or 10 year time period where we can see what the long-term consequences. We all know that in history, there have been medications that have seemed really great at first, but over time we have discovered that there are negative long-term consequences.
I don't discourage
anybody from getting the vaccine if they do their research and they want to get vaccinated. As I say, I'm vaccinated myself, but I don't think we should be forcing it on anybody. I believe in our bodies, ourselves, and I believe that with vaccines, I believe that with abortions, and I believe that
Let's oppose the rights of typhoid Mary. You're in favor of typhoid Mary.
All right, guys. We'll take this offline.
I forgot it's what I want to say, but it is one fool at a time.
It's a new level of nonsense.
All right, Charlie, you're the greatest violator of the one fool at a time right now. I'd like Ellen has been at 6 minutes, so now we're
okay. I'm done then.
Anybody else want to rebut, or else I'm going to let Justin Tucker go and get our final say in. So, Justin, are you there?
I can I correct some things?
Go ahead.
I'm
go
absolutely
ahead,
here.
All right.
Okay. I'm a retired family nurse practitioner after 35 years in nursing. So I do know something about contagious diseases. The point of getting a vaccine is to prevent yourself from getting very ill, because if you're not vaccinated, if you are vaccinated, if you do get COVID, which happens because this last iteration is extremely contagious, and in fact, you can give it to other people, but when you get it, you're not as sick. You're not as likely to be in the emergency room, in the hospital, or in an intensive care unit. One. Two, part of the difficulty now is that people who are in the hospitals, who are sick enough to be in the hospitals and are in the intensive care units, 90% of them or more are unvaccinated. They get a much more severe case of COVID for the most part.
Margaret, I have a question. What do people get from negative?
Can I just finish my thing here? Because now you're distracting me and I'm an old lady, so fuck. Anyway, so the whole thing, and now the problem is that people who have refused or couldn't get a vaccination are filling hospital beds. And in Illinois, and in many states, there's an emergency now because people who need intensive care, people who are in automobile accidents and have severe injuries, people who are having heart attacks, et cetera, there's no beds for them. They have to go miles out of the way to get to a hospital that has a bed that can accept them for treatment.
Margaret, answer my question.
The whole point that Ellen is doing is bass ackwards. It's not that you can give the infection to other people. Yes, and yes, you can. But the point is that people who are unvaccinated are filling our hospitals, and there isn't room for us to treat other people.
I've heard those statistics. I've heard other statistics that it's not 90%.
Well,
I've heard other statistics.
I don't know who the hell you're listening to, but who tells you that it's less than 90%? The medical and public health authority that tells you it's less than 90%. I want to know that.
Okay. What about the people tested negative?
More and more people.
Thank you, Margaret.
One full at a time. One full at a time.
You don't have a citation. Because read it somewhere.
What do people test negative?
I've heard statistics in various places that I'm not sure I trust the official statistics. We're talking about...
Okay.
Well, where do you get your statistics? I get mine from the CDC.
So I can cite it.
I'm not sure I trust the CDC 35
years when I was a nurse.
One full at a time.
The hospital made their infectious control standards and their practices and their policies based on things from the CDC. And that's been for 100 years or however long the CDC has been in existence.
You know,
that's where I get my statistics.
Illinois Department of Public Health.
You know what I find very statistically? I'm a huge
one
number
full
of people
time.
With natural immunity, a huge
time.
Number of people who are vaccinated, and yet there's a claim
it's
that
Margaret
all
Stern.
These endless unvaccinated
no.
people who don't have natural
Guys.
Immunity are filling up Ellen, the
it's Margaret's rebuttal.
I'm done.
Margaret, answer to me.
Scientific sources for her.
Okay, Margaret, answer. What if people have negative tests? They feeling fine. What about Mayor Lightfoot? She had 2 vaccinations, 1 booster, and now she have COVID. How about
well, you
that?
Know what? It depends on the immune system. It's the luck of the draw who you breathe in and who's breathing on you.
Okay, so Margaret said she was done. Is there anybody else that's giving rebuttal?
Yes, I have rebuttal.
You already gave rebuttal.
All right,
a re-rebuttal.
You can only give one rebuttal.
A re-rebuttal.
Margaret, you gave 2 rebuttals.
You gotta move on.
I didn't
give rebuttal. I'm not
sure. That's a rebuttal.
Let's not pursue this rabbit hole anymore because we're getting off topic here.
Really,
like
how
Justin.
Come people have 2 vaccinations, 1 booster, and they have COVID? It depends from immune system,
it's
guys.
It's just the luck of the draw who they come into contact okay. with and what their own immune system is doing.
All right, Margaret, I let you go again because, you know, you always give a good rebuttal to Ellen.
Oh, now we got to give everybody.
No. I just said I let it go once.
I didn't
Justin,
even.
Justin, final remarks. Take as long as you need, and we'll go from here, okay?
Can you see the police lights flashing on my head?
Yes, I can. I can. Okay, Justin, please, you got the final word.
It's because I live across the street from the 14th district. Okay, so I just want to say thanks, guys. I had a good time. Did you guys have a good time?
With yeah, these
good.
Yeah, we did.
All right, let's look at some more memes.
Oh, God.
Hey!
So I'm gonna share my screen.
Please give me.
Do you guys see it?
Okay.
Justin, can you load those memes from Frank Herbert that I sent you?
Sorry, I didn't see those in time.
Oh, no worries.
All right, so here's Ron Paul. It's happening. This is a very popular meme. It's basically like when something the libertarians are onto something that's happening. This is, so these are memes I actually made and I want Carl Carl to throw our logo on here. But Houston, taxation is theft. Frankly, my dear. Rosebud and taxation is theft. 7 things every kid needs to hear. I love you. I support you. I'm listening. I believe in you. I'm here. All gun laws are unconstitutional. I care about you. Bernie, the expectation. Let's just say I don't have to worry about working for a while. Reality. I'm starving. I can't feel my stomach sucking up my spine, up against my spine. So this is from the Venezuelan May Day revolution or attempted revolution. Was it on May Day? I don't remember. I think so. Adam, maybe you should correct me on that. But basically, this is the Venezuelan uprising.
The one a couple years ago or the one like 20 years ago?
A couple years ago.
All right, maybe, yeah.
Anyways, so this is the Venezuelan government running over somebody. The guy getting run over, it's not real socialism. And then the Venezuelan government running him over is real socialism. Get it? It's being literal, sort of. So you got the Hulk when he's mad, the left when Trump kills brown people. And then you got the Hulk when he's kind of calm, the left when Obama killed brown people. So this is Bernie on his way to a rally to rail against the 1%. He's Scrooge from Disney. So the government is Indiana Jones. He's getting ready to swap out my rights, the idol, for empty promises of free shit. Thinking about losing weight, what method do you think is the most effective? Paleo, keto, Mediterranean diet, socialism at 65%. Wow. Don't tread on me. Come and take it. Dates do not have to cost money. Here's 8 free date ideas. Walk in the park, dinner, at home, watch a movie, make memes, debate economics, protest the police, start a militia, overthrow the government. Don't really do that. That's a joke. I watch enough Fox News to know that ISIS is going to attack my Podunk town's DQ. Liberals, we want the government to control healthcare. State government bans abortion. Liberals. There's Dorothy from The Wizard of Oz in Venezuela. Toto, I have a feeling we're not in Illinois anymore. So there's a guy with his headphones plugged into the toilet, listening to Bernie Sanders, AOC, Robert Reich, or Elizabeth Warren talk about economics. Promising socialism, implementing socialism. If you're a fan of the Game of Thrones, then you get that, I suppose. So the Constitution's the tree, and then there's the dog doing his business. Every president of the United States you have ever voted for. I don't know, do we got any Hebrew people in the audience can read that and tell me what that says? But it's a porcupine, Israeli libertarians, looks like. When you tell her taxation is theft and she says, I know. Let's say it loud and clear, women control their bodies, not the government. Say it loud, say it clear, gun owners control their guns, not the government. Adults control their health care, not the government. Wage earners control their money, not the government. Market coordinates time with interest, not the government. Private companies and consumers control the market, not the government. When you want Trump to build the wall, but then remember the wall killed Dale Earnhardt. John and Yoko waiting for the maid to make the bed so they can continue protesting against the system. Okay. Imagine there's no heaven. Yeah. Bernie, when he found out the Nordic socialist countries have privatized Social Security, no minimum wage, lower corporations, no estate tax, lower corporate taxes, excuse me, no estate tax and freer markets than the US. Hold up. There's socialism, skunk, and you got democratic socialism putting on some Stetson cologne. Bernie Sanders, I will find you and I will tax you. AOC, in theory, socialism. She's cute, right? In practice, kind of not very.
Not the best tattoo artist.
All right, so you got the praying the woman. That's my Rhodes. Praying the taxpayers that are, you know, but really, endless war, the police state, wasteful social programs. Okay. Who will build the roads? That's why we have to have government.
He's gonna lose his head.
So always remember to wash your hands after playing with animals.
Okay.
So. The dog meets a socialist, communist, and washes his hands. All right, so here's Neo from The Matrix. When someone tries to shoot you, but the gun control laws kick in.
Okay.
Throw bread on me. The Trump cult and the Bernie cult coming together for economic illiteracy.
Oh my God.
Greed, guns, and prison are what's wrong with America. Now give me 90% of your income or I'll throw you, send men with guns after you and put you in prison. Taxation means levying a tax, Levy means to impose. Impose means to force. So taxation is force, or coercion and compulsion, especially with the use of threat of violence. Interesting.
That's not that true.
Fight the system. Yes, it is. Bigger.
No, it's not. I don't like that talk that the government is violence. You're talking like Proud Boys.
One full at a time, sir.
No, you don't put. You don't say.
One full at a time. One full at a time. One full at a time.
Get it? No.
One full at a time. 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 One full.
You don't fucking tell us the government is violent, boy.
One full at a time. Proud Boys.
All right, Charlie. Would you please let us let Justin finish? No.
Now you control these guys. We're not a militia.
I'm controlling them now, and I think we're getting a little bit too many memes in our end rebuttal, but.
You let refuse fascism say it, Charlie. Now.
All right. Let Justin, please go ahead and finish your stuff. And
all right. Let's see where we're at here. Let me see if I can find a really good meme to end on. Give me just a minute.
Thank you, sir. All right.
Oh man. Okay.
Well, let's find that last good meme.
All right. There's so many. Oh my gosh, they're so good. Okay, here's, oh God. All right, here we go. Bernie Sanders, bread lines are great. Change my mind.
Okay, Justin, we'd like to say thank you very much. We will continue this call after we're done here, but at this point I'm gonna officially end the proceedings for the College of Complexes tonight.
Good one.
And thanks everybody for participating.